Need I tell you, you're looking in on the Orange Bowl at Miami, Florida. I don't see a moon over Miami anywhere tonight, although the temperature is in the high 60s as we're about to begin tonight's ball game, the 43rd annual Orange Bowl Classic between the University of Colorado, the co-champions of the Big Eight, who finished with an 8-3-0 record coached by Bill Mallory, going against Ohio State, making its first appearance ever here in the Orange Bowl. Ohio State, co-champions of the Big Ten with Michigan, with an 8-2-1 record. And down on the field right now, the Colorado band is playing the Golden Buffs alma mater. Earlier, we heard the Ohio State band and their alma mater. And, of course, also coming up tonight is the great pageantry that we've come to know and expect over these last 43 years of the Orange Bowl. And tonight, in a few moments, you'll see the 1977 edition.
We, the University of Colorado football team and the coaching staff, are very proud to be here to represent our fine institution, the University of Colorado, our great state and beautiful state, Colorado, and what we think is one of the finest, if not the finest, conference in the country, the Big Eight. We're proud to be here to represent all of these people. We look at this bowl as a real challenge. I think it's going to be one fine game tonight. I do want to also wish all of you people who are watching here this evening the best and a very happy new year.
I've been asked what this game means to me. It will not be played for the national championship, but any time we promise to play a football game, there's a tacit acknowledgement there that we'll play our very, very best. And I'm sure the team whom we play, Colorado, will do the same. It'll be a great contest. I like to feel that college football is the most intricate game ever invented. And it's a game that's been built on integrity. And I don't mean to imply that we're the only ones have that, because we see that in other both amateur and professional sports. But without that integrity, our game would be worth nothing. So those of us in it must make sure when we play and when our players play that we go all out, because that's the integrity that makes it the great game that it is.
Postseason collegiate football reaches its climax as Tony Reed leads the Buffaloes of Colorado against Pete Johnson and the Buckeyes of Ohio State in the 1977 Orange Bowl game.
NBC Sports is happy to bring you on this New Year's night from Miami the 1977 Orange Bowl, the Golden Buffaloes from the University of Colorado versus the Buckeyes from Ohio State. Brought to you by Pontiac and your Pontiac dealers, the people who build and sell Grand Prix, Bonneville, and Sunbird. By Texaco, who invite you to visit your independent Texaco retailer for quality gasoline and other fine automotive products. By AC Delco, quality automotive parts for quality motoring. Go with the names you know, AC Delco. And by Goodyear, makers of the American Eagle Radio, a new kind of tire built especially for the American road. And hello to you, and Happy New Year to you. I'm Jim Simpson, along with John Brody, a couple of co-champions tonight. From the Big Eight, we have Colorado. From the Big Ten, we have Ohio State.
Well, Jim, when I look at this game, to me, it means like Woody Hayes has already been there. However, whenever he's coaching a team, it's not just another day at the plant. We all know that. But on the other side, Bill Mallory, this is the most important game he's ever coached. His program can really get over the hump and be recognized with the likes of a Nebraska and an Oklahoma, and I think that's what he intends to do.
Bill Mallory used to coach for Woody Hayes, and they're two very different kinds of men. Now let us see about these men in a very special way, starting with Woody Hayes.
I've grown accustomed to his face. He almost makes the day begin. I've grown accustomed to the two. His frowns, his ups, his downs are second nature to me now. Now breathing out and breathing in, I was serenely independent and content before we met. Surely I could always be that way again, and yet I've grown accustomed
That's Woody Hayes. I wonder if Bill Mallory of Colorado would be concerned that we call him a good old country boy.
Well, life on the farm is kind of laid back. Ain't much an old country boy like me can hack. It's early to rise, early in the sack. Thank God I'm a country boy. Well, a simple kind of life never did me no harm. Raising me a family and working on the farm. My days are all filled with an easy country charm. Thank God I'm a country boy. Well, I got me a fine wife, I got me old fiddle. When the sun's coming up, I got cakes on the griddle. And life ain't nothing but a funny, funny riddle. Thank God I'm a country boy. When the work's all done and the sun's setting low, I pull out my fiddle and I rosin up the bow. The kids are asleep, so I keep it kind of low. Thank God I'm a country boy. I'd play Sally Gooden all day if I could, but the Lord and my wife wouldn't think it very good. So I fiddle when I can and I work when I should. Thank God I'm a country boy. Well, I got me a fine life, I got the old fiddle. When the sun's coming up, I got cakes on the griddle. Life ain't nothing but a funny, funny riddle.
I just found out two things I didn't know. You like country music, and Bill Mallory rides horses. And a lot of people didn't know much about Colorado before they came down here. A lot of people still don't know much about them, even though they are the co-champions of the Big Eight.
Well, the co-champions of the Big Eight is the co-champions of the best conference in football right now, collegiate-wise. I don't think there's any doubt of that. They've been saying it for a long time, but this year there were six outstanding football teams. A team like Missouri, who was tied for fifth in their conference, we saw them beat an awful lot of football teams. Now, in order to move the ball in that conference, it's necessary to have some offense. And Colorado does a multiple of things. They have a kid like Emory Moorhead that's out there, makes a lot of big plays for him, comes into the backfield, helps them out a lot. Tony Reed's done a fine job. We know we'll see him all night. Jeff Knappel is a kid that came on, wasn't noted to be able to do a whole lot of things, but he's done everything effectively. He's moved the team. He's scored points. That's all you can ask of a quarterback, and I think you're going to see a lot of offense.
Well, what about defense against a running team of Ohio State? I'll ask you about Ohio State in a moment, but now let's get some specifics about Colorado. If the Golden Buffs are to move the football tonight, it'll be number 19 Tony Reed who will do much of the moving, a senior out of Wichita, Kansas, who actually played his high school football in Japan, where his father was in the Air Force. He leads the Colorado Golden Buffs with 264 carries for more than 1,200 yards. He also leads the team in the number of passes caught. The quarterback is young Jeff Knappel, number 12, who took over in midseason. They say about him, he doesn't throw particularly well. He doesn't run particularly well, but he moves the ball club every time he comes in. In other words, Jeff Knappel is a winner. The game breaker is Billy Waddy, number 38, possessing great speed. He's averaging better than 30 yards per catch this year. And the All-American Don Hasselbeck, the tight end, 6'7" tall. He is a big one and a good one, weighing 245 pounds. In the middle defensively, watch number 72. That's Charlie Johnson, at one time weighing 300 pounds. He has slimmed down to 260. It'll be up to Charlie Johnson to stop the Ohio State running attack up the middle tonight. Johnson has some help from his friends, Vaughn, right there as Colorado can mount a defense against the run. Now you can talk about a very familiar name in football, Ohio State.
Well, Jim, I think Ohio State offensively has changed that old cliche of 3 yards in a cloud of dust to like about 4.5 yards in a rug burn, at least in Columbus. I haven't seen a whole lot of changes in Ohio State's offense. They do the same thing. They have big people up front. Only their center isn't a big man. And they have excellent backs. Now, Jeff Logan's come on, done a great job. They're a good one. They have a lot in the bank they haven't shown. Maybe we'll see it tonight.
And, of course, they've got great defense. But now let's look at specifics of personnel of Ohio State. There's been some question who's going to start at quarterback tonight. Jim Pacenta, number 15, who wound up the season after Rod Gerald was hurt. But Pacenta is a strong runner and also a very capable passer. He's a man that did not play too much through his first 4 years at Ohio State, but may get his big chance to shine tonight here in the Orange Bowl. Pacenta can throw, probably the better thrower in the club, and his favorite receiver is Jim Harrell, who leads the team with but 12 catches. Ohio State's thrown only one touchdown pass all year. But when you think of Ohio State, you think of the big fullback, Pete Johnson. 18 touchdowns this year, 57 touchdowns in his career at Ohio State, bothered with sprained ankles. But if you overload against Pete Johnson, there's always the good tailback, Jeff Logan, who traveled for 1,169 yards and averaged nearly 6 yards per carry in 1976. And Ohio State is always known for defense. Here is Bob Rudzinski, the All-American defensive end, who also drops off as a linebacker, who is credited with 4 interceptions this year. Ohio State always has good linebackers, and here's one of them, leading the club in tackles, Tom Cousineau, number 36, coming into your picture right now. Those are our football teams, and you will see them in action in a few moments. And now, before this large crowd, if you've been to an Orange Bowl before, you know what to expect. Pageantry. Let's go down to the field for a pregame pageantry for the 43rd Orange Bowl Classic.
Well, how do you feel about America now? After a year of bicentennial, do you still have that good old red, white, and blue American pride? I sure do, and I don't ever want to lose it. Do you? That's the spirit. A little flag-waving music, if you please.
I'm just a flag-waving America, a citizen I'm really proud to be.
Some people call me Old Glory. Some call me the Star Spangled Banner. Whatever they call me, I'm your flag. The flag of the United States of America. I remember some time ago, people lined up on both sides of the street to watch the parade. And naturally, I was leading every parade, waving proudly in the breeze. What happened? I'm still the same old flag. Oh, I have a few more stars. A lot more blood has been shed since those parades of long ago. But now, I don't feel as proud as I used to. Is it a sin to be patriotic anymore? Have you forgotten what I stand for and where I've been? Take a look at the memorial honor roll sometime of those who never came back to keep this republic free, one nation under God. When you salute me, you're actually saluting them. Well, it won't be long until I come down your street. So when you see me, stand straight. Place your right hand over your heart, and I'll salute you by waving back, and I'll know that you remember. And now, to honor America, let's join in the singing of our national anthem.
That is Ralphie, the mascot of Buffalo. They had a contest and named him Ralph, and then they found out he was a she, so they changed it to Ralphie. Not only that, folks, Ralphie is expecting. And we are expecting a great ball game here tonight between Ohio State, the co-champions of the Big Ten, and, of course, Colorado, the co-champions of the Big Eight. A We're also expecting at halftime to see the halftime pageantry. Now coming onto the field, Colorado from the far side of the field, and in a moment you'll see the big red of the Buckeyes of Ohio State. And Ralphie leads.
I don't think Ralph has got enough help, Jim.
And there are the Buckeyes. Ohio State, 8-2-1. Colorado, 8-3. And as you can see, they're more than ready for the opening kickoff. They're charged up. They've been down here for some days getting ready for this game that will be played in 60-degree weather. And we'll be back in just a moment for the kickoff for the 1977 Orange Bowl.
This is the beginning of a new four-cylinder engine from Pontiac. Cast iron tough, but smooth, with 2.5 liters of Pontiac power. This is the Iron Duke, and only Pontiac's got it. In the sassy new Astra, the classy new Sunbird, or the great new Ventura, a tough, smooth, powerful four made by Pontiac, the Iron Duke was born to rule.
You are watching two automatic typewriters in action. One is the best known. The other can automatically type in both directions at the rate of up to 350 words per minute. The automatic typewriter that's twice as fast is made by Xerox. That's right, Xerox.
And our thin and crispy crust, the cavatini oven baked pasta, really is a must.
There's a lot of good things at Pizza Hut. There's a lot of good things under our roof.
The season premiere of college basketball features Michigan against South Carolina and Houston against UCLA tomorrow, beginning at 1:30 Eastern Time on NBC.
Our referee is Robert Carpenter, and we're about to have the flip of the coin. George Manning, the head linesman, field judge Gerald Austin, Tom Chambers is the umpire, the line judge is Jimmy Rosser, and Gil Rushton is the back judge. But our clock operator is Dick Pace. Carpenter describing what he's about to do, which means heads, you call it, tails, I got it. And then we'll take a look. Oh, gee, John, I thought he was going to toss the coin. There he goes. Buckeyes have won it. They want the football, I'm sure. Gets to keep the souvenir coin. Colorado elects to take the field to our right. The entire Colorado team is out at midfield. The Buckeyes now go out to join them at midfield.
They may just stay there for 4 or 5 minutes, Jim. Looks to me like...
I'm sure that you saw the Rose Bowl that preceded this. USC defeating Michigan by the score of 14-6. And the Cotton Bowl this afternoon, Houston defeated Maryland with a big first half, 30-21. And Pittsburgh, number one in the country. They started the day. Looks like they'll wind up right there, knocking off Georgia 27-3. And now we come to the climax of this New Year's Day of bowl games. We're in Miami with the temperatures in the high 60s. The weather's perfect. No rain at all expected. But what is expected, a good football game between two co-champions. Two good football conferences. The Big Eight, represented by Colorado, on the far side with their head coach Bill Mallory. And John, as you said, this is the whole ball of wax for him to get his program really off the mark.
And I think also, Jim, that with Ohio State taking the ball on the first drive, what we might be able to notice is the ability of a Mark Lang, the center. He's only 212 pounds. He's up against a guy like Charlie Johnson, who is the real stud of their defensive line. You mentioned earlier he's lost 30 pounds. He only weighs 265 now. But I think we're going to see the best matchup of the day. If by hook or by crook, Lang can handle Johnson, I do believe they'll be able to run the football. And if not, it may be tough.
On the near side of the field, Woody Hayes and group still talking before going out on the field. Some people down here at Miami said that Woody Hayes was taking this game lightly. I think his statement at the beginning of this game took away any thoughts of taking any game in which he coaches lightly.
Woody Hayes taking a game lightly. It might be a game of ping pong or something after he's practiced 4 or 5 hours and shown game films to 3 or 4 more. His coaches have been in a regular routine since they've been down there. His team has had very little free time, and this is a big ball game, and anytime Woody Hayes is involved in a football game, it's everything.
Back in Colorado, they're not surprised at all, but perhaps you listening around the country will be surprised to know that number 4, Mark Zetterberg, who will tee it up and kick it off, is an opera singer and is signed with the Seattle Opera Company and is also a drama major. And he'll be kicking off to the Ohio State team. The usual deep man back there is Jeff Logan, number 34, but we'll wait till they pan out to see. There goes Logan, number 34. Round springs 23 on the near side. And Matt Jackson on the far side, 47. Well, we waited a long time for this, and the 1977 Orange Bowl is about to get underway. And Zetterberg will kick off. High, very short, Matt Jackson going for it and watching it go out of bounds across the way, and they'll have to kick it again. Unlike Ohio State, which has a fine place kicker as well as punter Tom Skladany, and he's been there all year long, and Woody Hayes practically dubs him the franchise, the Colorado Golden Buffs have had Tim Mangnall, who's got a bad knee, Mark Zetterberg, they have Stan Koleski to do the kicking, he's a Navy veteran. And they had another kicker who was wiped out by a knee.
And usually, Jim, when that happens, you find inferior kicking games. In this case, however, I'm very impressed with the fact that they're particularly the field goal kickers have kicked an excellent percentage of field goals, and they really haven't dropped much when one man went down.
Ball is placed back at the 35, and Zetterberg will kick off, and that's Jeff Logan saying, come up a little bit, men. Jeff is standing on his own 7.
I don't think he was too impressed with the first one.
Better foot still toward Matt Jackson on the far side. It takes it at the 13 to the 20. Down the sidelines he goes and will be knocked out of bounds. That's the crosses midfield to the 48-yard line where Ohio State will put it into play. Jim Pacetta, number 15, the quarterback. Jeff Logan, 34, the tailback. Pete Johnson, 33, the big fullback. Your tight end, we'll have to check on that. It is expected to be Storr, number 80. Your wingback, Jim Harrell, number 11. Herman Jones, 49, the split end. Chris Ward, the All-American. Lou Petrini, the tackles. Jim Savoca, Bill Lukens, the guards. And Mark Lang is at center. Joe Robinson is your starting tight end, number 90. Flag is down as Jeff Logan carries the ball across the 45 and Reuben Vaughn makes the stop there. Referee will tell us against whom this is to be marked off. And obviously it's to be marked off against Colorado. Robert Carpenter will tell us why. They were offside. Now we know it, that Herman Jones is not in there, and Greg Storr, 80, and Joe Robinson, 90, two tight ends are starting, and now we see that Robinson is coming out. Now he's going back in. There's some confusion in the Ohio State line. Now Robinson, who's all the way out, goes all the way back in, as Jones has replaced Harrell, the wingback, instead. Might be a mix-up here, as Logan carries the football, as another flag goes down. Charlie Johnson, Reuben Vaughn made the stop. Well, we have a chance here. Stuart Walker, 93. Reuben Vaughn, 75. Charlie Johnson, 72. Lavelle Short, 92. He's got his work cut out tonight. And Randy Westendorf, 80, are your front five. Brian Cabral, 49. Bill Muxlow, 59, your linebackers. Otis McKinney, 28. Mike Spivey, 47. Your corners, Mike Davis, 36. Mark Haynes, 18, your safety. And as you can see, the penalty instead was against Colorado. Two plays, two penalties. First down, Ohio State. The ball at the 38-yard line of Colorado. Harrell is wide to the right. Robert! Jeff Logan trying to get outside, being strung out beautifully outside and knocked out by the freshman Mark Haynes. A loss on the play.
You bet. Mark Haynes did a fine job, but Stuart Walker forced the play the whole way. When you have excellent people to that wide side of the field that are real fast, big enough to be able to handle the blocks initially, you can really string things out. And when you do, Colorado can play defense. That's the way they've been doing it all year.
Now Ferguson comes out, and Herman Jones comes in as a split end, and Jim Harrell stays in. Interesting matchup tonight will be the defensive tackle, freshman Lavelle Short, 92, against the All-American Chris Ward, 79, of Ohio State. Second down for center Slips, gets the ball away off the hand of Logan. Right there, ready to level him, was Mike Spivey. And it'll be third down, 11.
Jim, the impressive thing to me there was that he had good time to throw. When he set up, he did slip, and it fouled up his whole pattern. But oftentimes in collegiate football, as you can see, they put the offensive linemen are really have most of their weight forward. They're not accustomed to pass blocking. This is an excellent job of pass protection. He could have stood back there and directed them after the snap of the ball. That, you get that kind of shot, anybody can go.
Passing situation, Bobby High, 35 is in. Flag is down. It looked like they had the safety blitz on, and if they did, the man might have stepped across the line of scrimmage before the ball was snapped. Colorado is very eager tonight. They've already drawn two penalties, and let's watch to see if they get a third.
Let's take a look. You see the free safety. You see Mike Davis coming in. He just puts that one foot across the line of the ball, and had he not come quite so far, it'd been all right, but it really got caught.
Still third down and nearly six to go. Herman Jones comes back in as Jones and Hyde and Harrell are bringing in the plays from the bench. Harrell goes wide to the left. Jones comes to the right. The center, he's a blitz to goal. He's lost the football. The center goes back for it. Colorado jumps on it. Belongs to Colorado. The center drops the football. And Lavelle Short, the freshman from Littleton, Colorado, number 92, made the recovery. Ball back inside the 45 at the 43.
Jim, it looked like they sent the whole house. That time Randy Westendorf got there so fast, he was almost there before Pacenta was able to get there himself. And when that happens, it's no pass play.
Jeff Knappel, 12, the quarterback. Tony Reed, 19, the tailback. Jim Kelleher, 42, the fullback. Tony Reed, the man we expect to see, dives to the 40-yard line. Steve Gaudy, number one, is the split end. Don Hasselbeck, you won't be able to miss him. He's 6'7", is the tight end. George Osborne and Matt Miller, the tackles. Steve Hakes and Doug Griffin, the guards, and Mike Tope at center. And Short, whom you saw along the sidelines, is the man who recovered the fumble. Gain of three by Tony Reed. It is second down and seven. No score early first quarter. And now, Knappel lost the football. Kelleher is on there. Now that offensive line that we've already given you, but they have split tackles and tight tackles. But we'll call them left tackles and right tackles. They will flip-flop them. George Osborne and Matt Miller, the tackles. Steve Hakes, Doug Griffin, the guards, and Mike Tope, the center. Matter of fact, on defense, both teams will flip-flop to the closed side or the open side of the field. Third down, seven to go for Colorado. Knappel back to throw. Gets the ball away, and it is bobbled, but picked up and caught by Emory Moorhead, and he's close to the first down and may have it. Inside of 35.
Well, they've been saying all week that they intend to do a number of different things with the football. They feel they have to against a defense as effective as Ohio State is. Knappel's been a thrower that seems to get it when they need it. Emory Moorhead's been doing a big job for him all year, and you saw a perfect example of it.
Gaudy goes out, and Bob Nozolik, another tight end, comes in, number 84. Two tight ends, and they've got the power eye. That's Tony Reed, and Reed battles down to the 50, perhaps the 29-yard line. Well, it'll be second down and about seven to go. 76,732 tickets were sold tonight, and including all of the bands and the governors from both states and the bus drivers and, of course, we, the press. There are over 79,000 here looking on. Scoreless, 11:50 to go, first quarter. Second down, eight. Dapple hands off. That's Reed showing some of that open field running, getting inside the 25-yard line, down to about the 23, before Cousineau made the stop there.
You see the tight end, Hasselbeck, who's 6'7", about 240 pounds. Anytime they can run at him, they do so. You can see how strong he is and effective at the point of attack. When you move a defensive end back 7 or 8 yards, a lot of ball players can pick it up for you.
Bob Brzezinski, Nick Bonamici, Aaron Brown, Eddie Beeman, Kelvin Dantzler, the forward five for Ohio State. Cousineau and Thompson are the linebackers. Knappel with the, well, he handed off the football instead of Jim Kelleher. And under there is Jim Kelleher, number 42. They'll move the sticks again. That's another first down. Mike Guest, number 12. Tom Roach, 26. The corners, Joe Allegro, 22, and Ray Griffin, 44. The safeties, or Apaches, or boundary men. Colorado calls them Apaches. Ohio State calls them boundary men. Apple pitches back. Reed down the sideline. Allegro got a hand on him as he went out of bounds.
Oftentimes, Jim, you'll see a team running a good degree to the weak side of the field. Now, to an observer, it looks like a silly thing to do when you have so much room on the other side of the field. However, Ohio State's defense pretty much dictates that you must run that way, part of the game at least, because they've got people shifted over to the wide side of the field. They leave both Eddie Beeman and Kelton Dantzler all over there with a lot to cover. Eddie Thompson's backing them up. You'll see him go short side a lot.
Second down and five. Straight ahead goes Kelleher, battling inside the 10-yard line, and he's got another first down. Jim Kelleher. This was all set up, remember, by the fumble by Pacenta on a third down pass play. This is Gaudy coming out this way. Gary Doolin is in their goal line set up for Ohio State. Second man through. That's Reed and not much. No question about the Buckeyes of Ohio State. They can play defense. There's Doolin, number 60, who comes in goal line situations. Number 9 is Ed Thompson with all Big Ten again. And it is second down and 8 to go. The ball is just over the 8-yard line. Gaudy again wide to the left. Reed coming to the far side and slips as he tried to cut back inside and may have lost a yard on the play. And there's Ray Griffin at the bottom of the stack along with Eddie Beeman.
Jim, as you mentioned, Ray Griffin, he has been cheating up several times defensively. I don't know if he's going to shoot in a short period of time. By that, I mean safety blitz. Obviously, they don't throw too much, but it's not a bad idea in a running situation, so you may see it. They need some help inside.
Gaudy and Moorhead both go to the right side, the open side of the field. Looking out there, putting the ball too low, and get it to Emory Moorhead at the goal line. And it'll be fourth down. And on comes the kicking team. Zetterberg will come in to attempt the field goal. 5 for 10 for the year. His longest is 48 yards. This will be nowhere near that distance, as they'll spot the ball at about the 17. Make that the 16-yard line, a 26-yard field goal attempt. Kick is up, and it's Colorado to put the points on the board first. 9:04 to go, first quarter. Colorado taking advantage of the fumble recovery. Moves in for a field goal by Zetterberg.
There's a challenge in the sunrise. He can hear the highway call. City roads and tough roads, he can take them all. He's the eagle, he is sure. He's the eagle, he'll endure. Stretching out in front of him, going everywhere. The city, the country, mountains and valleys, he will take you there. He's the eagle, he is sure.
hear American Eagle Radio with Flex 10 cord belts instead of steel. Flex 10 is made from a flexible man-made aramid fiber that's pound for pound stronger than steel. The American Eagle, the strong, smooth riding radio.
The tire for America. The American Eagle. The tire for America.
The Golden Buffs of Colorado will kick it off again. And Jeff Logan again becomes a deep man with Matt Jackson on the far side and Ron Springs on the near side. Zetterberg, with his 26-yard field goal, had four field goals against Nebraska, the only points Colorado got, but that set a school record, which counts for something, I guess. Gets good foot into this one. Jeff Logan takes it at the nine. 20, down the sideline, cuts back, knocked down inside the 45-yard line. Storr sprung the block and Chick McCarter, number 43, out of Fort Worth, Texas, knocked him down.
Jim, the surprising thing is that they're kicking the ball exactly where they want to. However, I don't think they would like to have Jeff Logan with the ball. They do feel they've got a crack over there. They found it twice, perfectly set up the block. This time, Jeff Logan gets down to the 41-yard line. That isn't too shabby.
49-yard kickoff return. Pete Johnson comes out of the ball game. That means that Paul Campbell, 38, becomes your fullback. The setup, whoops. Logan with the ball and no place to go. Mike Davis, number 36, came up to force the play and there to help out with Stuart Walker.
We mentioned earlier that Mark Lang has his hands full with a Charlie Johnson in the middle of the line. Now, I've noticed that they're having a little problem getting the ball from center. Pacenta hasn't gotten it cleanly three or four different times. That could be an effect of a Charlie Johnson standing right over your nose. He knows his job is a big one, and it's got to get cleaned up before they can operate effectively.
Herman Jones has brought the play and goes wide to the left at the top of your screen on second down and 10. The center, back to pass, and he is thrown, and that's that man again, number 72, Charlie Johnson.
Here's what we discussed. You see Charlie Johnson on the left, on the right shoulder of Mark Lang, who's trying to handle him. It's the toughest block you can have when somebody's in the gap. Charlie Johnson just splits them both, gets the placenta before any pattern can get set up, and that is an awfully tough way to have to operate.
A loss of nine, third down and nine. Can you imagine that man used to weigh 300 pounds? And they said even when he weighed 300, he moved very quickly. But now that he's down to about 260, 265, he's much quicker. Harold goes wide left. Jones comes to the right. Passing situation, and Pacenta goes back. Pacenta's got some running room. They're coming up. He will not get the first down. It will be fourth down and about eight to go as Mark Haynes submarines him inside the 40.
Again, it was the pass rush that dictated. He did not want to have to run. When you have to pick up 18 or 20 yards, the defense loves it. They got good defensive penetration, and that's the key to breaking up any pass game. You see Charlie again, and now they put an extra guy on him. Here comes LaBelle short around. They still have time for their secondary to recover. 8 yards gained, but they're still 12 short.
Rod Gerald came in, and Pacenta started out, and Pacenta got halfway to the sideline and said, hold it, we want timeout. 7:06 to go. With the first quarter in Miami, Colorado, 3 Ohio State, nothing.
Stanley Tools and Hardware have been helping people do things right for over 100 years. And today, people are depending on Stanley quality more than ever. They're doing things themselves to save money. They're also discovering that doing things with your own two hands adds something to life that money can't buy.
Stanley, we want to help you do things right.
And making our home beautiful is doing things right.
Stanley Tools Hardware and Drapery Hardware.
We want to help you do things right.
Many of today's tough business problems are really communications problems in disguise. And we in the Bell System can help you solve these problems. We have developed communication systems industry by industry for which we take total responsibility from design to installation to maintenance. In fact, we have committed all of our experience and our resources to this kind of problem solving. For we believe that the system is the solution.
One of the most explosive dramas of our time. Arthur Hill stars in the true story of Judge Horton and the Scottsboro Boys. Monday at 9, 8 Central and Mountain Time on NBC.
A field goal attempt of 56 yards will be attempted by Tom Sladeny with Hyatt to hold. Sladeny's kick is up. and is going to be short and into the end zone. Lanini has good foot. By the way, the Ohio State offense thus far has netted minus 22 yards. Well, tomorrow, NBC's second year of regular season college basketball tips off with a national doubleheader. Grandstand comes on the air at 1 o'clock Eastern Time, followed by top-rated Michigan, featuring Richie Green and Bill Hubbard, and South Carolina. Dick Stockton and Billy Packer will report that game, and then after that's over at 4 o'clock Eastern Time, powerhouses UCLA and Houston, Pauley Pavilion, Los Angeles. Dick Enberg, John Wooden, the ex-UCLA coach, will provide the commentary for that one. College football, of course, the ball comes back out to the 20 after entering the end zone, and so it is from there that Kelleher makes the first running play and gets perhaps to the 21. Call it second down and 9. Ohio State has not been able to move the football. The lone drive, capped by the 26-yard field goal of Zetterberg, was of 43 yards in 11 plays for Colorado after the recovery of the placenta fumble. And we have 6:37 to go here in the first quarter in Miami. Gaudy goes out wide to the right. Power eye. Reed, another yard or two, out to the 23-yard line, and that's about all.
Jim, you can see it's a big job ahead of the offensive line for Colorado because they have a very young one. They've been very effective. They are probably as instrumental in why Colorado is in this bowl as any other group of people. You know, you have guys like Steve Yates and Mike Cope, Dave Griffin and Matt Miller. These guys are all sophomores and juniors. George Osborne also. And for them to move the ball well tonight is a big thing.
Third down and 8 to go. Knappel looks as though he's going to throw. Gets the ball up, throws for Moorhead. Across the 40 to the 43-yard line, where it's first down, Colorado.
The impressive thing, Jim, is that Knappel threw the ball right at the right time. He dissected the zone. He had Moorhead in between. He hit him right on the dead run just before he went out of bounds. You'll see he threw it. This is the way you designed the play to go. His first receiver was Moorhead. Didn't have to go any further. Made an awful nice throw.
Billy Waddy, number 38, who has great speed, replaces Moorhead for the moment. There is Emory Moorhead, who caught the ball and just went to the sidelines. Pitch back.
Oh, they've got
it. Open to Waddy, and he's got a lane down the sideline. Roach is after him. Cuts inside, and Roach helps trip him up. First down inside the 20. That's the Billy Waddy we were talking about in the pregame. He's the game breaker.
Jim, they had so many people out in front of Waddy that had they been able to coordinate who to block, they'd have run it in easily. There are only two Ohio State men even aware of where the ball was at the time. You see the flow. They've got excellent pursuit. However, the ball's going the other way now, fellas. And as Waddy gets out in front, you see all of the Colorado blockers out in front of him. Here comes Mike Cope. And Tom Roche made a good play to get there in time.
40-yard carry. Takes the ball down to the 18. Reed slips one tackle, gets inside the 15-yard line. And down he goes there. Ray Griffin in on the tackle, along with Aaron Brown, the middle guard. There's Tony Reed. Most unlikely story. Moved all over the country, went to high school in Japan. A man who later coached in Arizona remembered having seen him in Japan, recruited him for a tiny college there, later switched to Colorado, and here he is in the Orange Bowl. Second down. Apple still with the football, and it's pitched back in out of bounds. Goes Moorhead with no room to run. They're lost on the play. Knocked out of bounds across the way by Cousineau, Tom Cousineau, who led the team in tackles this year. And as they like to say in football broadcasting, he's only a sophomore. Ball is put back on the 18-yard line, third down, and 9 to go. Our score, 3-0 Colorado, 4:25 to go first quarter. Waddy is in and out to the right. Gaudy comes wide left. The freshman, Mike Guess, is on him. And they're rolling toward the open side, looking, and it is caught by Hasselbeck. That is shy of the first down at the 10-yard line.
He came up about a yard or two shy. Good defensive play by Ohio State. It looks to me as if they're going to have a go at it on fourth down. They do have a long 2 yards to go.
Well, they're going to take a little timeout as we can see number 12 trotting across the field. That is Jeff Knappel, who's going to talk to Bill Mallory and see what it is he's going to do. It's fourth down, And about 3 yards to go, with 4 minutes and 1 second to go here in the first quarter, Colorado leads 3-0.
Coke is like, it's like a taste and a feeling you like. Coca-Cola, Coca-Cola. Come on, girl, gotta share a Coke with you. Coca-Cola. Let the feeling of you. You wanna live a little bit more. That's what the taste of Coke is for. Coke is like, everybody wants a little life. Coca-Cola, Coke is like.
Car 88 responding.
This is Bob Hope for Texaco. Recently, more than 40 state trooper cars using Haviland Super Premium all-temperature motor oil were driven a total of over 2 million grueling miles. Of the engines taken apart and inspected, none showed any sign of unusual wear. With Haviland's carefully balanced formulation, you get all this protection without buying any extra motor oil additives. Trust Texaco to protect your car like a trooper with Haviland Super Premium all-temperature motor oil.
Jim Simpson with John Brody in the Orange Bowl. Mike Caron checks in as a second tight end. It is fourth down and three to go. The ball at the 10-yard line. They've got the tower formation, the straight T. Knapple got it. He's got Moorhead out there. He's got it. Touchdown. I'll tell you, Jim, that's a great play by Moorhead as Knapple rolled out in the power eye. I'm sure they haven't seen the play, and the reason they went for it is because all week long you prepare for certain down and yardage situations. I know they have a play that when they get into a situation with two or three to go, they love it. They must have seen it in the film, because under normal conditions you put some points on the board. However, this play opened up so clearly. Moorhead made a fine catch of a ball that was pretty low thrown. But that's, in my opinion, why they used it.
An 80-yard drive in just 8 plays against this vaunted Ohio State defense. And Zetterberg adds extra point. Check that. That's Magnol who came in to add the extra point. In any event, it is Colorado, underdog by as much as a touchdown or more in the minds of many, that leads Ohio State 10-0 here in the first quarter with 3:54 to go. Next Sunday, an outstanding college basketball matchup precedes NBC's coverage of Super Bowl 11. That'll be Maryland and North Carolina State, perennial powerhouses from that Atlantic Coast Conference. Tip off at 12:30 Eastern Time. And then Grandstand will have a special Super Bowl preview at 2:30. And at 3:30 from the Rose Bowl in Pasadena, you got it, Oakland, Minnesota, for the National Football League supremacy in Super Bowl 11. Two teams that a lot of people have said along the way cannot win the big one. Well, somebody's got to win it next Sunday afternoon, and NBC will be right there to tell you which one did it. And they both won a lot of big ones to get there. That's kind of an overrated phrase.
That's one of those phrases that when someone says it, everybody else hops on it. Ohio State still minus 22 yards thus far. Colorado 113 yards. Ohio State no points. Colorado 10. Zetterberg to do the kicking off. Whips this one along the ground where it is picked up by one of the up men. That is Harrell, and Harrell gets across the 45 to the 48-yard line. And each time, Ohio State has put itself in excellent field position on the return of the kickoff.
Well, they'd had enough of that other treatment they gave them. They slipped it down to the right side twice and had it run down their throat. This time they squib kicked it, and the left side broke down a little bit, and they got it out almost to midfield. Now, that's about as good a position to start the football as you can find. They'll have to make some points pretty soon.
Rod Gerald comes in and will be your quarterback, number 8. And Ron Springs, 23, is your tailback. Along with Jeff Logan, who moves up to the fullback spot, it is Gerald, the quick quarterback, who's got the football, and he's got the first down. He was hurt earlier in the year. That opened it up for Pacetta, but Gerald is all right now.
They make no secret about the fact that Rod Gerald is an excellent all-around athlete. He can throw the ball a little, however, he doesn't throw it much. This is a beautiful fake. Sucks in the whole Colorado defense. He gets out there. He's only in a one-on-one situation now with Otis McKinney. McKinney made a pretty good player. He's going all the way.
I guess that's Ralphie behind there. Looking out.
that's a fearsome little devil.
Well, you know that Pete Johnson is out, and Logan has moved into the fullback spot. And that is Logan with the football right there, and he may go all the way. Touchdown, Ohio State. 36 yards, Logan from the fullback spot.
Great, great quickness. Logan got in the secondary very swiftly, but once he got there, he knew just what to do. He fits it back to standing flat-footed. He's a pretty tough kid to bring down. You see, two plays, they're in the end zone. You get that kind of field position, something good has to happen. Now Logan goes right through the right side of the line, gets into the secondary before anybody knows how to handle it. Bibby makes a try at him. Not good enough. 6 points, Ohio State.
53-yard drive, the last 36 by Logan. Ladany is in to add the extra point. It is good. 3:11 to go. And I'll tell you something, if you didn't know it, we've got a football game. I knew it. Colorado scored the first 10 points. The first three set up by Pacetta's fumble. Then they marked with a touchdown pass to Moorhead. And now this gentleman right here, Jeff Logan, whose father also played for Woody Hayes, not at Ohio State, ambled in from 36 yards out. So we've got better than three quarters to go. And maybe both coaches are right. They said they're going to put points on the board.
They've done so already, so I think you can expect a game when they have 2 or 3 weeks to prepare, and both teams have been relatively conservative all year, to do something a little different. Both have put a few ripples in their offense. Ohio State has put less than Colorado. However, they did come out throwing the ball a lot more than they have in the past. Now they put Gerald in, and he runs it right down their throat.
Ladany will kick it off, and the man in the middle is Billy Waddy. Remember that long 40-yard run he had a little while ago? Outstanding speed. In football, they like to measure in 40-yard bursts, and he has been clocked at 4.25. And if you don't know, that's quick. Bill Mallory along the far sideline. Ladany. Oh, good foot. Waddy's not going to bring it up. He'll stay right there, so it'll come out to the 20-yard line, first and 10. Colorado has not made too many substitutions today. Tony Reed and Jim Kelleher and Jeff Knappel have gone all the way. Moorhead and Waddy have alternated. They brought in all three tight ends thus far. Hasselbeck, Mazolik, and Kieran. Gaunty has been the lone split end, and he is now wide to the right at the top of the picture. First man through is Kelleher for perhaps a yard. Not much more. Colorado has been known to score some points. Against Oklahoma, 42. Against Iowa State, 33. Against high-scoring Oklahoma State, 20. And allowed Oklahoma State just 10. Missouri bumped them. But then there's another team on the field that can say the same thing. Second down and 9 from the 21-yard line. Hasselbeck, gee, he's big. Look at him on this end. 6'7". That's Waddy coming out of the backfield. Pitch back to Tony Reed, and he does well to get a yard or two.
He did pick up 2 or 3 yards, but it's awfully difficult to sustain consistently an attack against that defensive front line of Ohio State. We see here their whole group, Cousino. You see Brudzinski. Now, here's an All-American from way back. He can handle a whole outside of the field. They call it the open side of the field. He and Bonamici, those guys are outstanding players. Eddie Beeman, he's another tough one. Where do you pick? It's pretty hard running up inside.
Gaunty brings in the play. Moorhead caught the touchdown passes back in. On third down and 8, but it's given instead to Reed, and he's not going to get the first down. Tony Reed tackled by that same man again, Tom Cousineau, the sophomore. So Colorado will kick it away.
It really looks as if Colorado has done what they intended to do. However, they're in a 3rd and 8 situation. Cousineau isn't playing the run real tough. He does make a fine play once they get past the line of scrimmage.
Stan Kolesky, who is near 30, believe it or not, is the man who kicks it away. He was in the submarines in the Navy. Griffin calls for a fair catch at the 32-yard line. Well, it'll be 1st and 10 there, nearly the 33-yard line for Ohio State. Archie Griffin, the two-time Heisman Trophy winner, is in attendance down here after playing his freshman year in the National Football League with Cincinnati. And one of his brothers, Ray, is a starting safety, and another, Duncan Griffin, is a sophomore you'll probably see a lot of before the night is over. And they tell me that they've got a brother at home in the 8th grade, and John Brody said 8A or 8B.
They know.
First down, Logan still out of that fullback slot. Now, Pete Johnson came into the ball game with bad ankles. He did start, but without the first quarter even gone yet. Johnson is out. And another Johnson was in on that play, Charlie Johnson.
Take a look at the nose guard. Here you go. You've got Mark Lang. It's his job to handle Charlie Johnson. It's a tough thing to do. This time he gets a little help from Savoca on the right, and the play's back in action.
Dell pitches out to Springs, and Springs gets away from Davis and down the sidelines and out of bounds. First down, Ohio State. Brian Cabral knocked him out of bounds. Well, if it were not Pete Johnson, we expected and were told we would see Paul Campbell. But Johnson not effective, apparently. Instead, they move Logan up. He scored a touchdown, and Springs comes in to take Logan's place. Springs is very quick. Another one of the younger member of the Buckeye team. 45 seconds to go in this quarter. 10-7, Colorado. Gerald, as the flag goes down, tries to turn the corner, does turn the corner, and gets down to the 47-yard line. Cabral made the stop there, number 49, getting up, but there's a flag down.
And if they don't make him do something pretty swiftly with the ball, he'll kill you running that option, because you give him enough chances to option on different people, he will pick up some yardage.
Gerald is coming out, and I don't know if he's hurt his hand or what. The penalty is against Ohio State, taking the ball back to the 44-yard line for illegal motion. But Pacenta's coming back. There's the illegal motion right there. That was Storr, the tight end. But Pacenta has gone back in, and Gerald is still out and being ministered to along the sideline. Looks like it could be a wrist. Oh, it is first down and 15 to go. Ball at the 44. Look out. I would say that Charlie Johnson moved rather quickly. Was he drawn offside? They don't even they don't even fool with that. They just pick up 5 yards and say Charlie jumped.
Yeah, but once he knew he had the five, he didn't waste any time getting the percenter. He knows he's already committed. He's made the mistake. It's time to do some damage, I guess.
Ball back at the 49. First down there. Herman Jones wide to the right. Campbell has now come in as Pacenta's back to throw. Gets away from a couple of folks and gets down to the 46-yard line, where he's knocked down there by Gary Hartley, who's in at defensive tackle, and Stuart Walker. Second down and five. That's the end of the first quarter, and it's been a very exciting first quarter. Colorado had a 10-point lead, but the quarter ends 10-7 to Golden Buffs.
When I started at 6 in the morning, I held the determination to do the best I can.
Frank Mason, Quality Control. This is who we are and what we do at General Motors.
I get prepared for today, take my gloves and get them all ready for today's run. Job requires skill to find the faults of this hood coming down the line. Once the paint is on, you can see every defect in the whole hood. But otherwise, when it's in the rough, you hardly can see it. The only way that you can do is feel. You've got to be completely smooth. That's the main idea of just the smoothness of the metal. Well, you've got to have real concentration. Keep your mind right on that job. Keep it where you're feeling quality. I'm pretty proud of myself after working all those years at General Motors. I think I've done them a good job, and they have been very good to me.
General Motors. People building transportation to serve people.
Catch all the action as the Minnesota Vikings take on the Oakland Raiders in Super Bowl XI next Sunday, beginning at 3:30 Eastern Time on NBC.
Second down five, Ohio State on the Colorado 46-yard line. And now we see Joe Robinson coming in as they regroup. Colorado outrushed Ohio State, and Ohio State got 0 yardage passing. Herman Jones wide to the right. Second man through is Springs with that quickness, and he may have the first down down near the 41-yard line. Hartling, who replaced Lavelle Short, made the stop. Let's pause briefly for station identification. This is the NBC television network. Well, our assumption is, John, that Chris Ward had been doing a job on freshman LaValle's short, so they're giving Hartling a go in there.
Well, that would be an assumption. However, I do believe Short is hurting a little bit. Now, you know, Hartling did have the job early in the year. However, Short came on so fast, he got it back.
Well, we understand now, ice on his ankle, it's sprayed. That's why Hartling is in there. Hand off, very quickly looking for the first down. Cabral makes the hit.
Pretty hard to determine whether they do have the first down or not yet, but you can see Ohio State gets off on the ball very well. However, they're met just as rigidly by Colorado's defense. In the short yardage situations, these guys know when the ball snapped, everything breaks loose. And they held him about a foot short of a first down.
The ball carrier is Paul Campbell, is listed as a fullback, who's running out of the tailback spot. So Ohio State's mixing up that offensive look. It's fourth down and about a yard to go, and Colorado calls the timeout with 13:54 to go in this half. Well, we'll come back to balmy Miami. Yeah, I hope it's not too cold where you are. We got a good game. 10-7, Colorado.
The American Eagle, Goodyear's symbol for its all-American kind of radial tire. Goodyear is committed to product innovation. We introduced rayon cord in tires. We created the polyglass tire and the polysteel radial. And now the American Eagle, with belts of Flex-10 cord instead of steel. Flex-10 is made from a flexible man-made aramid fiber that's pound for pound stronger than steel.
The tire for America, the American Eagle, the tire.
The Pabst Brewing Company makes this pledge of quality to you. We make no compromises in brewing Pabst Blue Ribbon. We only use nature's choicest ingredients. Every glass meets the standard of quality we set as America's first premium beer. Take the Pabst Challenge. Taste and compare Blue Ribbon with any other premium beer. Our quality is not just in our pledge, it's in our taste. Pabst. Since 1844, the quality has always come through.
For the first time on TV, a major motion picture tells the real story of the most daring rescue of our time. Raid on Entebbe. Super Bowl Sunday at 8, 7 Central Time on NBC.
Rod Gerald is back in. He has his play. Bill Muxlow is back in with a defensive play. Full house backfield. Ohio State fourth down and one. Gerald keeping the football, turning it up, and getting the first down inside the 40-yard line. Cabral is down at the bottom of the pack, along with Muxlow. First down, Ohio State.
You can see this kid has put some excitement into Ohio State's offense. Now, he really adds a new dimension to their offensive structure. They had to play defense very well. He picked up 2 or 3 yards on his own just with his great athletic ability.
Ohio State continues to substitute liberally with Harrell, Jones, Hyatt, Storr, and Robinson. Wing backs, wide receivers, and tight ends shuffling in and out. Gale's got that football, turns it upfield, and picks up yardage inside a 35-yard line. And he is exactly what they said. He is quick. And there are some who say in Columbus, Ohio, that he might be even quicker than Cornelius Green was. And he was very quick. Charlie Johnson, the big middle guard, is down on the field at the 42-yard line and is hurt and will be ministered to. And he is the man they need. You've already seen that. LaValle Short, who plays right tackle, has gone out. Injured. Now Charlie Johnson, who is the middle guard, is hurting along the 40-yard line. And the man who replaces him, Johnson, weighs 264. Tiloi Lolotai weighs 217, the middle guard that would have to replace him.
Even if he was a big man, when you lose a man like Charlie Johnson or LaValle Short, now that's two out of your three down linemen, you are hurting against a team as big as Ohio State, because they love to run and control the ball on you. Keeps your offense from getting a chance to get the ball. It just does a whole lot of things that dictate the outcome of a football game. And this guy has been their big playmaker defensively all year.
It'll be second down and three when time is in. Charlie Johnson will get up. See if he is limping. He's holding that right leg up, not wanting to put it down. Vietnam veteran, big man, quick man, and a good middle guard. Being led off the field. Second down and three. And the addition of Rod Gerald has been something. It has added a quickness to that Ohio State offense. Campbell is in there again as a fullback. Pete Johnson is not. Straight ahead goes Ron Springs. And Springs, I believe, has got the first down, or perhaps a little shy at the 30-yard line.
It is near the 30-yard line.
Well, I don't think I need to say anything. It hurts. Now again, Pete Johnson comes back in. Bill Jaco comes back in. And this is a short yardage situation. Third down and inches to go. And they'll use the full house backfield again. They want their fullback Johnson to get it, and he does. Reuben Vaughn makes the stop, number 75, along with Muxlow, 59.
Take a look. It's a little bit surprising that they're going right at Reuben Vaughn, because he's a big, strong man. Now, Pete Johnson's also at 240 pounds, a pretty big man himself. And you can see now the surge is starting to take over. Ohio State has just run the ball down Colorado's, right down their throat the last couple series, and primarily because of those two injuries.
Ball on the 28-yard line. First down. Gerald, first man through is Logan, who bursts down to the 20-yard line. Jeff Logan. Bill Muxlow hanging on with some help from Brian Cabral. Now it'll be second down and 3 yards to go. The first quarter was nearly all Colorado until the 36-yard scamper by Logan to make it 10-7. The second quarter, which has not yet gone 4 minutes, has been Ohio State. Harrell is wide to the right. And there's Rod Gerald, the sophomore from Dallas, injured much of the year with a bad back. Springs easily has the first down to the 15-yard line. Hartley made the stop. He's replacement for Short, number 73. But they're not even trying to go outside. They're simply ripping right up the middle.
Right now, Jim, they haven't had to go outside. There aren't too many secrets. They're coming right at you. They've got a great tackle in Chris Ward. They're running right behind him now.
Flag was down on the play. Offside charge against Colorado. Refused. They'll take the first down. And now Frank Patrick comes in for the forward wall, number 64. The next to down lineman. Hit almost immediately, but still picking up some good yardage. Vaughn made the hit of Logan, but he still picked up 3 or 4 yards. Jim Harrell checks in with the play. Herman Jones goes out, and Ohio State, which might have been shocked for the moment, 10-0 has roared back. Charlie Johnson has an injured right foot. We'll get a further diagnosis when we can. Down near the 11-yard line. Ohio State continues to roll, and Reuben Vaughn still has to make the tackles, and Ron Springs looked just as quick as always. And now we come to a rather big play. With the ball at the 11, it is third down and 6. Logan in the fullback spot. Springs behind him. And Gerald, the quick quarterback, and he is going to be hit. And it's going to be fourth down.
Jim, that's the first time I've seen them do what I think is the way to stop a guy like Gerald, which is make him make a decision very swiftly. They shut him off before he could get the play drawn out. When you do that, you cause him to turn back inside, let the pursuit pick him up or get him yourself or whatever. Mark Haynes makes an excellent play right here. He turns the whole shooting match in, and you can't gain 6 yards that way.
From 28 yards out, with Wyatt to host, Ladany will try to tie up this ball game. 28-yard field goal is good. And we've got one in hand. 9:33 to go in the half. And it's all even Steven. Colorado's Golden Buffs, 10. The Buckeyes of Ohio State, 10. And we'll come back to the Orange Bowl in a moment.
You remember, not so long ago, when a new kind of automobile came blazing out of the future to set your heart on fire. Who could forget the first wide-track Bonneville? Pontiac hasn't forgotten, because Pontiac has done it all over again. This is the newest Bonneville since Wide Track from the people who keep coming up with the great ones. Wait till you try the new headroom and the new rear legroom. Remarkably, this trim new Bonneville has more of both than last year's Bonneville. Even the trunk has more room this year. A tough, taut Bonneville. Born for performance. Born for maneuverability. With all the engineering know-how of the Wide Track people. Right at your fingertips. Bonneville. First of the new great ones from Pontiac. And you can test drive it at your Pontiac dealers now.
Pontiac, the mark of great cars. Pontiac.
LaDainey will kick off. Billy Waddy, James Mayberry, and Emery Moorhead, who has scored a touchdown of the deep men. But then he really has got a lot of foot. This is Waddy. He'll take it at the three. He's the quick one, remember. Fourth in the nation in kickoff return, but he's knocked down and knocked down hard as he crosses the 20-yard line. Looked like Bruce Rule who made the stop, number 43.
Bruce Rule made the stop, Jim, but I'll tell you, David Atkins got down here and busted up the whole wedge, number 94.
First down, and now let's see if the Golden Buffs of Colorado can get something going again. They had a 10-0 lead, now it's 10-all, and we've still got a lot of time here in the first half, 9:29 to go. They show us the power on with Reed in motion. And Napple handing off to Kelleher, who got a couple of yards out to the 25-yard line, and that is about all. Eddie Beeman in on the tackle.
Jim Kelleher carried.
Along with Nick Bonamici.
On tackle.
Second down and eight to go.
2 yards on the play.
There's the Colorado bench. What a story that Big Eight was this year. Everybody was in contention. And Colorado, by virtue of beating two of the other co-holders of the championship, other ones who are here. Kelleher again carrying the football. And I think you can see Eddie Beeman again, the man who made the stop. Number 67. Beeman tells a story about being in Cincinnati. He's from a family of 13, and his high school coach came to him and said, Woody Hayes wants to see you in the cafeteria. He couldn't believe it.
I tell you, Kelton Dantzler, the man on his left, number 32, is only from a family of 10, so they've got... There's 23 kids in those two families together, and they're having a go at them. They seem so far to be very equal to the task.
Jim Sawicki is in there as the middle guard now. Aaron Brown is out. Napoli's back on third down, throwing over the middle in a crowd. Has his man, the ball is dropped by Tony Reed. Would not have been a first down. Reed was sandwiched at its fourth down, and Colorado's going to have to do something they did not want to do. Get the ball back to Ohio State, which has shown an ability to run inside. Dan Kolesky with Joe Allegro deep. Rushes on, gets the ball away, and he got away a good kick. Allegro says, I'll take it a fair catch. Drops the football. Battle for it. Still loose. Belongs to Colorado. Jim, and I'll tell you something. Ohio State, I believe, only had 9 men on the football field. Colorado came up, lined up real fast for the punt. There was some confusion in Ohio State sideline. They only had 9 men back there. It allowed a whole bunch of people to get down under that punt when he fumbled it. It was curtains.
And there's also a flag at the 50-yard line. So let's hold everything.
Penalties against Ohio State. It is refused, and they'll take the ball. And there's another big break for the Golden Buffs. And that is Stanley Brock, who is the brother of Willie Brock, who is the brother of Pete Brock, who is with the New England Patriots. Hello, Pete. And three Griffins at Ohio State, three Brock brothers at Colorado. One of the great stories, and if Pete Brock is listening, I don't mean to make fun of you, but it was a funny moment when he got sent in early on in the season. He checked into the wrong huddle. He went to the Oakland Raiders huddle. Little excitement. First down from a 36-yard line. Aaron Brown has come back in as the middle guard, number 55. Stepping out of motion is Moorhead. Napple carrying the football, optioning it out to Reed, and he's looking for somewhere to go and doesn't find much of anywhere to go. And he lost a yard on the play. Kelton Dantzler, number 32 over there, along with Ed Thompson to make the stop. Bill Mallory, one-time assistant coach at Ohio State, now the head coach of Colorado, and what a job he has done in his 3 years there.
And you can see why his record is 8-3 this year. He's done two or three things already that have given them big plays by design. And, you know, some, it doesn't sound like much, but when you send a group in to punt the ball swiftly and you get the other team with nine men, that's a big play by the coach.
Here's yet another look at a Colorado offensive formation we haven't seen. Across the way, that is Hasselbeck, the All-American end, 6'7". He didn't have to reach up for that one. Allegro makes the stop, first down inside the 25.
Have to be awfully, an awfully good athlete in order to catch a ball that's direct, thrown directly at you as you're running down the field. Now, Knappel let the ball go at just the right time, just as Hasselbeck got between the defenders. Now you can see he has to turn on the ball, makes a fine catch, didn't have a lot of time to find it, picks up the first.
Ball is at the 24-yard line in this 10-10 ball game, 7 minutes to go, first half. Knappel still has the football, turns it upfield, gets inside the 20-yard line, down to the 17. Jeff Knappel, the sophomore from Boulder, grew up in Boulder. Everybody at Colorado wanted him. He said, I'm going to UCLA. Got out to UCLA for about a year and said, nah, I want to go back home. So he's back in quarterbacking the Golden Buffs tonight.
And doing a fine job. Now, some teams have made the mistake of saying that he can't beat you running the ball. However, he's proven them wrong two or three occasions this year, and you don't want to leave him alone.
He had a great game against Oklahoma. That is Keller going straight ahead. I was watching Gaudy, and you wonder when they're going to throw to Gaudy. He's only had 13 catches all year, but he has been carrying Mike Guest to the wide side of the field, about 20 yards from anybody else.
And Mike Guest is all alone over there. When you have the wide side of the field, as you do in college football, there's so much more room to the outside sideline. Mike Guest is the man that plays the best man-to-man defense. He feels he's all alone out there, and several times they leave him by himself.
He's an 18-year-old freshman out of Columbus, and they're up to a big down, third down and three. But we're in four-down territory. The ball is at the 17-yard line. Knappel again takes a look at something Ohio State is doing that he wants to check it out with his coach.
He saw a defense he didn't like. What happened was Guest was outside on Gaudy, and they looked pretty good for a minute, and they changed that, and he had to call time.
5:51 to go, first half. The Orange Bowl of Miami. There's Woody Hayes, and there's the score. Colorado 10, Ohio State 10.
How much does an oil company make on a gallon of gasoline?
30 cents. 30 cents.
A lot. You can bet on that.
Many people think oil companies make a lot more than they do. In the year that ended last June, Texaco, for example, made only an average of about 1.25 cents per gallon for all petroleum and products sold. And most of that has to go back into getting you the oil and gasoline you need. At Texaco, we're working to keep your trust.
With great skill and discipline, you teach what's been kept a secret for centuries. And when the lesson has been taught and learned, now comes Miller time. Time to head for the best tasting beer you can find. America's quality beer, Miller High Life.
If you got the time, we've got the beer. Miller.
In the Orange Bowl, Jim Simpson with John Brody. Charlie Johnson, Colorado's on offense now with a big play, 3rd and 3. But Charlie Johnson is having x-rays taken of his ankle right here at the stadium. Report when we get it. 3rd down and 3, Knappel rolling out. Knappel now gets the ball away and throws it past his intended receiver. Hasselbeck was there, and so was Keller.
Well, he was intending to throw the ball to Hasselbeck. You could see he was trying to find him. They had the play well defense. Hasselbeck kind of went around back behind into the center of the field against the flow, and Knappel threw it a little low. As you can see, they have him defense. Guest has come in and made a good play on it. He's got to go to the offside. It's a tough throw, but it was underthrown.
Vandenberg now will try a 34-yard field goal. Kick is blocked and goes out of bounds on the 1-inch line, perhaps.
Not
that
a good,
might be a great play.
Not a good deal when you get one block, but if you have to, send it out on the 1-foot line. We see there's real good penetration in the front coming right through. Somebody stuck a big paw up. Looked to me like it was Bonamici. Might have hit him in the head, Jimmy.
Well, here's Ohio State. Gerald comes up back in. I think you can see that, number 8. Keith Johnson is in, as they'll probably play this rather close to the vest down there. But Colorado's having trouble with both Charlie Johnson, Lavelle Short, injured and out of there. Johnson wedging it out to the 2-yard line. Cabral, Lolatai leading the tacklers. Muxlow's there. And it's second down. 5:25 to go in the first half. At halftime, of course, the bands of Ohio State and Colorado. And, of course, the halftime pageantry, which we all look forward to. 10-10 our score. That's Johnson again, and again another yard or so, not quite out to the 5-yard line. And Lola ties the man who got in under him and tripped him up. Number 52.
Well, you can see they're having to go at the replacements. Lola Tai, Hartling, both of them. They've got Chris Ward, their All-American center in there, number 79. He's having to go at Brian Cabral. However, they're doing the job. They stuck him right back there inside the 5-yard line, and if you're going to replace somebody, that's the way to do it.
Third down and 7 to go. Gerald keeps the football himself, turns it up, and does not get the first down. And the flag goes down and could be a late hit. Could be a late hit that'll cost Colorado and will give Ohio State the first down.
Boy, it's awfully hard when you're a defensive back to pull yourself up, particularly when you're trying to corral a guy like Gerald. Now he comes in here, and this guy's all pumped up. Mark Haynes is all pumped up to see what he can do to help. Didn't pull off in time, and that's the penalty.
Penalty was a good one. Takes the ball out to the 23-yard line, and they started this drive, remember, at the 1-foot line, and had been stopped and would have had to have kicked the ball away. But the late hit gets Ohio State first down. Logan and Springs are your setbacks. Logan in the fullback spot. He scored on a 36-yard touchdown run right up the middle. Gets another chance right here and turns it up again and gets good yardage across the 30-yard line. Picks up about 9 before Cabral makes the stop along with Haynes. Pete Johnson comes back in as we're going to have a short yardage situation. Jim Harrell brings in the play. And Jaco comes in as yet another tight end. Second down and a yard to go. Bulldogs backfield, you almost know who's going to get it. Pete Johnson's got it and has the first down up the 35-yard line. Stuart Walker, number 93, is the man who stuck him first. First down at the 35.
You know, Pete was the guy that they had expected so much of this year. He's everybody's pro prospect, and he really didn't have as good a year as they expected of him. Now, he mentioned he was going to have a big game this week. He got taken out early. I have a feeling somebody said something to him on the sideline because he's starting to run the way he can.
Mike Cilento replaces Mark Haynes in the backfield, number 9. Gerald with the football, pitching it out to Springs, and he's knocked out of bounds after picking up perhaps 3 yards to the 39-yard line. Haynes was guilty of the late hit, the freshman taken out, and Cilento put in. That's what they call the Apache. In most terms around the country, that's the strong side safety. Second down and 7 to go. 3:04 to go, and this is the first half. Now you can see Paul Campbell checking in. Johnson has played. Campbell has played. Springs, Logan. Woody Hayes is using 4 backs almost interchangeably. Gerald hands to Springs, the quick man, and he's got the first down across the 45-yard line, out to the 46. Mark Lang opened the hole for him, and Bill Muxlow got him after he got the first down. Along the Colorado sideline, they're talking offense. Well, I said they had the first down, and I'm going to be proven wrong.
That's all right, Tim. We'll give you one.
Missed it by that much. Third down and short yardage to go. Checking it out is Bill Lucas, who's a member of the College of Veterinary Medicine at Ohio State. One of the men that Ohio State's quite proud of, getting a 3-point
775 in the College of Veterinary Medicine, showing up for practice every day, captain of the team, and playing an excellent guard spot at that good old Ohio State offensive line. Third down and inches to go. Fullback takes it, first down, Johnson.
They stopped it up, Jim, but I'll tell you, the offensive line of Ohio State right now is playing the best football they've played in this ball game. They're moving off the ball. They're creating holes. And it makes it awfully tough to keep a good team from making 1 foot.
Johnson and Harrell come out, and Ron Springs and Herman Jones go in. Second man through is Springs, and he got submarine. Looked like Frank Patrick, number 64 in there, who did the job. Charlie Johnson does not have a broken ankle. Not a broken bone, but that's the good news. The bad news for Colorado fans is he will not play again tonight. The big middle guard, the man that they counted on stopping up the middle against Ohio State.
I have noticed that LaValle Short is back in the ball game, Jim.
Second down and 9. The ball's on the 47-yard line of Ohio State. Gerald is going to throw on second and 9, and he's now got some running room. He is quick. He is very quick. It'll be third down and short yardage as he steps out at the 46-yard line. Mike Spivey driving him out.
I guess that's as good as a completion. As you see, he was bothered early. It's awfully tough to perfect pass blocking when you run the ball as much as Ohio State does. They get the weight of their offensive linemen going forward. And when they are going to throw, they have to move back a little bit, take the weight off their front hand. And boy, it's a big tip for the defensive linemen. They get right in their starting blocks and go right to the passer.
Third down about a yard and a half, and now some confusion in the backfield as a couple of Ohio State men come in after the play's already been called. But what you do is give it to Pete Johnson is what you do, and he gets the first down inside the 40-yard line. Mike Davis made the stop along with
Well, I've been talking about him, Jim. Let's take a look at him. You see, they're all off on the ball very, very well. They get the ball to Pete, create just a big enough crack. As you see, Short has LaValle outside. Pete Johnson goes inside, and they pick up 6.
1:36 to go, and this is the first half. And we've got a tie ball game. Ohio State moving. They got a minute and 36 in which to move with the score tied at 10 apiece.
Hey, if your car has lost its pep and power and life is passing you by, if your fuel gauge seems to be the only thing that moves, it's time to see an AC Delco serviceman about a tune-up. He likely has the training, the tools, the know-how, and of course, quality AC spark plugs and Delco Remy ignition parts to help restore your car's performance. So,
a Royce CB radio.
Breaker 19.
A paint shaker. Your CB may never get torture like this, but bumps and jolts can be a real problem for some CB radios. That's why Royce is designed like this, with fewer wires, exclusive modular construction. Royce CB, it's built to take it.
That's a big 10-4.
And now, 40 channels and built to take it. The new Royce CB.
This drive, remember, started on the 1 foot line and was kept alive when Haynes committed a late hit on Gerald on a third down play. Ohio State would have had to kick it away, but instead the Buckeyes are in business. 1:36 to go in the half. Second man through is Springs. He is quick and gets down to the 35-yard line. The time becomes very important now, especially to a running ball club like Ohio State.
You can see Jim Westendorf, number 80, was standing back. He's expecting him to throw the ball. Since they only have a minute and 17 seconds, I can imagine he would. Had to come up, turn the play in, and they almost gave him 4 yards.
Second down and 6 to go. From the 35, and Gerald is going to throw the ball, apparently. Gets it away, and it is almost intercepted. Spivey really wants that football. It was intended for Herman Jones.
Well, I can understand why he might like it, because had he kept control of it, he'd have run it in. There was nobody down the sideline. He's trying to get Herman Jones on a simple little corner pattern. He throws the ball just a little bit late. Would have been completed if Spivey doesn't make a good play, but if he hangs on to the ball, he runs it in.
Third down and 6 to go with 1:04 to go in the half. Herman Jones and Harrell both go wide to the right.
Gerald looking to run. Oh, he's got the first down and more. Inside the 20-yard line goes Gerald. Everybody fading back in that Colorado defensive secondary and allowing him a lot of room in which to run.
Well, they faded back, but the problem, Jim, was there were only three men back there. They had a safety blitz on. They sent everybody after the passer. No secret they had to throw in that situation. Gerald found a little hole, and then it was three against three back there, and I'd hate to have to bring him down with all that room.
Well, you saw Gerald wig-wagging to the sidelines like he did not want to call a timeout. In any event, time is out with 56 seconds to go, and Rod is coming to the sideline.
Well, actually, you know what happened when he did get tackled. He knew time was coming down. He wanted to go back and talk. Their situation is completely different than it was before the play started, and he called it as soon as he went down.
Garth Cox comes in as an offensive tackle, number 78. Ohio State. Well, it was all Colorado early on. They built up a 10-0 lead, and lately it has been all Ohio State. They've tied it at 10-all, and remember, this drive started on their one-foot line. And they now got a first down on the 18-yard line with 56 seconds left in the half. Gerald, now with his instructions, comes back to the huddle. Earlier today, Pittsburgh defeated Georgia 27-3 in the Sugar Bowl, Houston 30-21 over Maryland in the Cotton Bowl, and USC 14-6 over Michigan in the Rose Bowl. And we're all tied at 10. Jaco comes in as a tight end.
You saw George Chomp there trying to make sure they had the right amount of men out there in the huddle.
Well, number 63, that big left tackle, don't let that number 40. That's Chris Ward. He changed his jersey. That's why Cox came in for a moment. Gerald dropping back, looking to throw, and has the man Harold inside the five-yard line, and they call time. Tackle made by Cilento.
Very well thrown ball by Rod. When you're throwing that ball over the middle down near the goal line, there's a whole lot of confusion. He picked him up at just the right time. There's a little confusion down there on the ball. I think Ohio State has decided to call time.
No, the clock stops on the first down. Now they start it again.
You can see he's back there to throw. He plants. He sees Harold all the way. Hits him right in the numbers. Very well thrown ball.
Ball is at the three-yard line. 30 seconds to go with the clock running. Johnson, touchdown! Touchdown number 19 for the 76 season. Touchdown number 58 for Pete Johnson's career.
We've mentioned Chris Short. We've mentioned the whole left side of the line. I'll tell you, Jim Savoca and Chris Short just absolutely wailed him out of there. I don't care who you are. Lolotai got there a little bit late, but all by yourself, that hole's too big to fill.
A 99 and a half yard drive, or 99 and three quarters. It was about on the 1 foot line. Sladanian is going to add the extra point, which he does, and for the first time tonight, it is Ohio State that leads 17-10. And let's look at a familiar sight, familiar at least to Buckeye fans, and that is a score by Pete Johnson.
Here goes Pete. I guess he's in these bowl games, he seems to pump himself up. I can still remember him scoring four a couple years ago. He gets into a position one-on-one with Lolotai with about 3-4 yards to work with, and that's all he needed.
Ladany will kick off. And I don't think we've seen the end of the scoring parade for either team yet tonight, but better than a half to go.
We saw earlier, Jim, the coach for Colorado talking to his offensive line on the sideline, and I think he's impressing upon them the importance in the second half of them moving that defensive line of Ohio State out of there on occasion so they can control the ball some, keep it away from Ohio State's offense, maybe score a few points of their own.
Waddy, Mayberry, and Moorhead are the deep men. But then he wants to kick it away from them, so he kicks it to one of the up men and gets the ball out to the 30-yard line, and that's about all. That was Keller, the fullback, and David Atkins made the stop, and a flag is down at the 32-yard line. With 20 seconds left, and they're talking to Ohio State. They're talking to Ohio State, but they're marking the ball off against Ohio State, taking it out to the 45.
I'm not sure that everybody's convinced that's the way it's supposed to go.
They're talking to Ohio State. They went the other way, so. Now they take it back to about where it was.
They've still got a ways to go. We can take a look. Here, Hasselbeck is in a little confrontation. You get a little hot when the opposing team scored 17 points, but don't take it out on the kicker.
They're saying that it's not right yet, and they're right. They're saying, hey, take it back.
That's right.
And so Robert Carpenter, in a moment of embarrassment, he made a 30-yard mistake, takes it back. Unnecessary roughness. Dead ball foul.
Against the Buffaloes.
First down and 25 to go.
Jim, I think they'll sit on the ball for the rest of the half there. A whole lot more bad things can happen when you're down there that close to your end zone.
Tony Reed, who's been pretty well bottled up today, tries to get unbottled and makes a nifty run out across the 20-yard line, but that may be the last play of the game in the first half.
Let's take a look. It's the first time we've really had a chance to see Tony Reed in a position where he could put some of these moves he has on people. He's an excellent runner inside the tackles. Got great quickness. Going to be a fine pro football player, but tonight he hadn't been able to get loose. That's the first trip.
Well, we've got the bands of Colorado and Ohio State. We've got the halftime pageantry coming up as the first half is over. Colorado led 10-0, but now trails at the half 17-10.
This engine is weaving its way through the mountains of Oregon and pulling the incredible weight of 13 cars with a strap woven from Flex 10 tire cord, a Goodyear exclusive. Tire cord is the main reinforcing agent in a tire. Flex 10 tire cord is made from a man-made aramid fiber that is pound for pound stronger than steel. Tensile strength is only one of the many performance properties in a tire, but it's one of the most important. Flex 10, the tire cord of the future from Goodyear.
The 1977 Pontiac Grand Prix is already inspiring legends. Some say it's the most beautiful car in America. Some say it's so responsive it almost anticipates its driver. And some say it's the most comfortable. The facts are these. Grand Prix is our ultimate Pontiac, and it's priced at $5,109.
Pontiac, the mark of great cars.
This is NBC News Update, brought to you by American Express Car. Here is Edwin Newman.
Good evening. Two fires in the Middle West have killed 14 persons. Eight died in a Chicago apartment fire, six children in a house fire in Grand Rapids, Michigan. Rafael Hernandez Colon, the outgoing governor of Puerto Rico, says that Puerto Rico should not become a state, as President Ford suggests, but remain a United States Commonwealth. Hernandez Colon leaves office tomorrow. Billy Graham has entered Mayo Clinic after an attack of phlebitis in the leg. He will undergo tests, no word yet on Graham's condition. In his New Year's message, Pope Paul condemned abortion, called it a contradiction of human life. In Indianapolis, Jacqueline Means became the first woman priest ordained by the Episcopal Church. And that's update.
Do you know me? They do in Aspen and Vail and other great ski resorts. When I use this, the American Express card. Don't leave home without it.
Old feature mystery movie. First, Mac escapes death, but he's not safe. Someone tried to kill him, and he'll try again. Rock Hudson is Macmillan. Then a fortune in diamonds and attempted murder spelled danger for the chief medical examiner. Jack Klugman is Quincy. Macmillan, then Quincy. 3 hours of action Sunday, starting at 8, 7 Central Time.
The field now as we return to halftime at the Orange Bowl in Miami is the University of Colorado Golden Buff Marching Band under the direction of Jack Foote.
42. And now the band concludes its halftime performance with the beautiful theme from Mahogany. The music Mahogany. Away, folks. We've just begun the fight here at halftime. That's the Colorado Golden Buffalo Marching Band, but this is the Buckeye Band from Ohio State University waiting to come on under the direction of Paul Drosty. And once we've heard the Ohio State Band, there is the pageantry of the 43rd Orange Bowl Classic here in Miami, Florida, in the Orange Bowl where the temperature is a balmy 60 degrees. And the football game is 17-10, Ohio State. The Buckeye Band kneeling in the end zone now, waiting for the Colorado Band to clear the field. And now the majorette. On either sideline as the drum major steps it out. The Ohio State University Band is ready under the direction of Paul Drosty. And let's watch and let's listen.
And a variety of precision drill movements. The theme from SWAT features the distinctive sound of the Buckeye Brass. A tune made famous by Maynard Ferguson receives the Buckeye Brass treatment. Eli's coming. Thank you. Something strictly American in origin has gained the affection of any international audience. The wonderful world of Disney and the Buckeye Brass join forces in an impressive finale, It's a Small World.
This crowd here in the Orange Bowl is in a holiday mood. We hope you are too. The University of Colorado Band and now the Ohio State University Band. And I can give you a hint about the halftime pageant. What happens if it rains? It never rains in the Orange Bowl. We'll see what happens. We pause for these messages from your local station.
Tuesday on Bob Bob Black Sheep, Happy Boynton gets upstaged by a movie star turned flyer. Then on Police Woman, Angie Dickinson takes her biggest gamble. Bob Bob Black Sheep and Police Woman. Tuesday, starting at 8, 7 Central and Mountain Time on NBC.
This 1977 Orange Bowl game is being brought to you by Pontiac and your Pontiac dealers, the people who build and sell Grand Prix, Bonneville, and Sunbird. By Goodyear, makers of the American Eagle Radial, a new kind of tire built especially for the American road. And by the people who bring you the bright, refreshing taste of Coca-Cola. Coke adds life to just about everything you do. I'm Jim Simpson with John Brody. We're in the Orange Bowl. It is 17-10 Ohio State, and it's that time again. It's time for the pageant. What happens if it rains? Let's see.
Each year, someone asks, what would you do for Orange Bowl halftime pageantry if it rains? Well, it's only rained on one Orange Bowl game, and believe it or not, that happened on January 1, 1962, the last time Colorado played in an Orange Bowl Classic. So, we've decided to commemorate that occasion with the pageant we should have had on that wet day in 62. Let's listen.
Just sit and putter. Life's candy and the sun's a ball of butter. Don't bring around a cloud to rain on my parade. Don't tell me not to fly, I've simply got to. If someone takes a spill, it's me and not you. Who told you you're allowed to rain on my parade? But whether I'm a rose of sheer perfection, or the freckle on the nose of life's complexion, the cinder or the shiny apple of its eye, I've got to fly once. Ready for me, love, 'cause I'm a comer. I simply got to march, my heart's a drummer. Don't bring around the cloud to rain on my parade.
Thank you.
Hawkins and the Liebenay Ensemble. Chester Wranglerettes. Is captured by the presence of our 1977 Orange Bowl Queen and Court. Here is Princess Susan Smith, Princess Deborah Matthey, Princess Krista Kesey, and Princess Lillian Riggs. Ladies and gentlemen, our lovely 1977 Orange Bowl Queen, Her Majesty, Miss Marjorie Lee Johns.
Another outstanding performance by the Orange Bowl committee, and I'd also like to say, patting ourselves on the back, our own technicians and production personnel, an outstanding halftime pageant. The score is 17-10. Ohio State leads Colorado. The teams are coming back on the field, and we'll be back after this.
We keep our prices right for you. You're the one. We start the day out right for
you. Gotta get up pretty early in the morning to beat McDonald's prices.
Sir? Sir, your change.
Change? Change?
For a change.
McDonald's good morning prices. They're a real eye-opener. Like two of our light, fluffy hotcakes with syrup and creamery butter, together with pure pork sausage, all for under a dollar.
Under a dollar?
Under a dollar.
Change.
You've got to get up pretty early in the morning to beat McDonald's prices.
Change?
Change?
I'll take it.
At McDonald's, we do it all for you.
Hey, this is Bob Hope. Jackie Gleason is coming to the Battle of the Duffers, and I hope you will, too. The Bob Hope Desert Classic, Saturday and Sunday, February the 12th and 13th on NBC.
We're back at the Orange Bowl for the 43rd Classic. I'm Jim Simpson with John Brody. You're looking at the halftime statistics. The way Ohio State was running without Charlie Johnson, the middle guard, you just wonder what was said at halftime, John, about what Colorado can possibly do to stop the onslaught of the Buckeyes, who controlled that late part of the first half.
Well, I think there were a few things that dictated the first half's outcome. One, the insertion of Rod Gerald. The other, the depletion of the front line of Colorado. When Charlie Johnson got hurt, they started to run the ball effectively. Now, if you looked at those statistics, Colorado has not made a mistake in that they haven't had any turnovers. On the other side, Ohio State's had two, and they're still leading by seven. Unless Colorado comes out and starts moving them up front, it may be a long night.
Well, they're going to get the opportunity to, because Tom Skladany will be kicking it off to the Golden Buffs of Colorado. In the first quarter, a Pacetta fumble set up the first score of the game, a Zetterberg 26-yard field goal. Later, there was a 10-yard pass play to Emory Moorhead from Jeff Knappel, and it was suddenly 10-0. And then they put Jeff Logan, Ohio State did, in a fullback spot. And nearly the first time he got the football, he ran 36 yards for a touchdown. And the first quarter ended 10-7. Yes, I'm watching Woody Hayes along with you.
He's looking for the manager.
A little bit later, Skladany added a 28-yard field goal. It was 10-10, and then Ohio State had a magnificent drive. A field goal was blocked out on their own one-foot line, and they drove 99 and two-thirds yards with Johnson going over from the three to make it 17-10. And now Skladany will kick it off. Waddy is the deep man. With Mayberry and Moorhead flanking him. Skladany has shown us the foot that Woody Hayes is very proud of. He can punt, he can kick the field goals, and he can kick off. This time he squibs it. That's Keller tracking it down, picking it up at the 16-yard line, and getting maybe a 5-yard return out to the 22-yard line, where Ken Fritz made the stop there. First down. Knappel, number 12. Tony Reed, the tailback, didn't get the chance to do much in the first half. Number 19, Jim Kelleher, the fullback, 42. Moorhead, 40, the wingback. Steve Gaunty, number one, the split end. Don Hasselbeck, 89, the tight end. The tackles are Osborne and Miller. The guards are Hakes and Griffin and Mike Topes at center. Reed trying to get something going, and Reed does get something going. Rambling across the 25, out to the 28-yard line. Before he is stopped there by Joe Allegro and Tom Cousineau. Brzezinski, 84, Bonamici, 75, Brown, 55, Beeman, 67, Dantzler, 32, the front five for Ohio State. Cousineau, 36, Thompson, 9, the linebackers, Guest, 12, Rose, 26, the corners, Allegro 22 and Ray Griffin 44, the safeties. It's second down and a long three to go. Apple, keeping the football, has the first down and down the sidelines to near the 40-yard line. They'll mark it at the 38.
When you see them run as effectively as they have in the past two plays, you can sit and wonder to yourself, why don't they run that play all night long? It's not that simple. What makes it work, the offensive line has moved them backward. When that happens, you can operate a whole lot of different kinds of plays. A simple little straight-ahead go on first down by Tony Reed, that time an option worked because he got good offensive surge on the left side of the line.
The Big 8 co-champions, Colorado, against the Big 10 co-champions, Ohio State. First down, ball marked at the 38-and-a-half. And Knappel to throw on first down. Gets the ball away. Down the sideline, he's got his man. Dragged down is number 19, Tony Reed, curving out of the backfield, all the way down inside the 25 of the 20-yard line.
What Knappel did so well then is Ray Griffin was on a safety blitz. He picked it up, he slowed the count down just a little bit, allowed all his linemen to see it. There was nobody out there to cover the intended receiver. Knappel slowed it down. He knew he was going to get a quick pass rush, put the ball right on the money. That's the way you play the game.
Tom Roche made the saving tackle. First down at the 20-yard line. That's Reed again. They're giving him the ball more and more, and this time he is hit down and hit down hard by Aaron Brown, 55, the middle guard. He was the first to get there. Beeman in on the tackle, Cousineau in on the tackle. So that's a loss back to the 23-yard line. It'll be second down and 13 to go. 17 to 10, Ohio State, early third quarter in balmy Miami. Gaudy comes wide to the right. Moorhead, who has caught a touchdown pass, is to the left. Knappel hands to Reed, who's got a couple of those yards back, and will be third and long. Kelton Dantzler made the stop. The Big 8 has done extremely well, thank you, in postseason play thus far. And the Big 10 came a cropper today when USC bumped off Michigan 14-6. The Wolverines for much of the year number one in the nation. Earlier, Pittsburgh, who lost, started the day as number one, defeated Georgia 27-3. Third down and a little bit more than 10. And Knappel rolling right. Knappel throwing out of bounds, Gaudy.
Boy, he was close, Jim. He thought he was in. However, from my view, it looked like he had stepped out before he caught the ball, and I believe that would make him ineligible.
That'll be third down and 10 and a half to go. Now here's where Jeff Knappel and Bill Mallory, the head coach, want to get something going, and they're sending in Zetterberg, the field goal kicker. Go back to one of the other cliches of football. You try to get some points on the board. It's fourth and long. Ohio State's very difficult to run against. Zetterberg does have a good leg. And he will try a 38-yard field goal. And the ball is not good. It goes into the end zone and will come up to the 20-yard line. First and 10, Ohio State. So that was quite a drive put together by Colorado, but it came a cropper. When Gaudy was out of bounds on the pass, that would not have been a first down, but perhaps they would have gone for it on fourth down. As it is, it's Ohio State's ball, first and 10 at the 20. Rod Gerald, 8, will be the quarterback. Now they've used Logan, 34, Springs, 23, Johnson, 33, and Campbell, 38. So we'll wait for the break from the huddle to tell you who. Jim Harrell, 11, Herman Jones, 49, alternate, bringing in plays. And right now it is Logan, Springs, and Harrell back there with Rod Gerald. The tight end is Joe Robinson. And they have another tight end, Greg Storer, 90 and 80. Two tight ends. And they're going to run straight ahead if they can. Jeff Logan gets a few yards before Stuart Walker. Now they went away from the middle, and they went away from the injured Lavelle Short then, and to the left side, and Walker was able to handle the play. Second down and 7.
He's going to have to handle a lot of them, because I don't believe you're going to see that ball going in the air Unless it's a fumble or the referee throwing it back to the line of scrimmage, Jim, as long as Ohio State has a lead. I just haven't seen it in the past. I see no reason to think it'll happen now.
Matt Jackson, 47, a freshman out of Fort Valley, Georgia, comes in. They like him. He's got a lot of speed. Harold comes out. Gerald has the football, pitches it back. It is loose, and it was fallen on by number 49, Cabral. And Colorado gets in another break. The third turnover for Ohio State.
Great play that time. I had mentioned earlier they had to contain him, make him make a decision quickly. That time they didn't do it. However, they sprung it out. He got the play developed. You can see that now here's Mark Haynes. He makes him make a play. As he does, you find several fellas all in on those fumbles. When they're not picked up, it definitely draws a crowd.
Well, here's a second golden opportunity for the Golden Buffs of Colorado early in the second half to get some more points on the board. Ohio State stopped them last time. Third fumble they've lost. Knappel keeps the football, and Salento comes in. Or rather, Ed Thompson comes in to put the hit on him. Number nine, good, steady senior linebacker from Waverly, Ohio, Ed Thompson.
And Kelton Dantzler's done an outstanding job on that short side all night long. They feel like they have a 12th man when they call it a boundary in the outside group. But he has really taken his job and put it to him.
Citrino's replaced Griffin at right guard for Colorado. Second down, 12. Knappel is going to throw the ball out. It is intercepted by Cousineau. Back across the 30-yard line and knocked out of bounds across the way by Tony Reed. And Cousineau makes the interception.
Hey, Jim, Cousineau that time had very little time to react to the ball. He had his man open. He thought he had him beat. As you see, here's Knappel coming back to throw. He sets up on a quick pattern, trying to hit a slant in. Cousineau had somebody in front of him even. How he got the ball, just an outstanding reaction. Maybe that's why he suspects he's being the linebacker he is.
Well, Cousineau, being a sophomore and being an Ohio young man, very thrilled to be in a bowl game and making the interception. First down at the 34 for Ohio State. They lead by 7. That time the turnover did not hurt them. Here comes Ron Springs this way, and he's wrestled out of bounds. But Springs may have the first down. Stuart Walker took him off. If they mark the ball at the 44-yard line, they will be very close to a first down. Springs is another of the young men. Cousineau, a sophomore, has just intercepted. Springs, a sophomore, has just carried for nearly 10 yards. And now they say that it is a first down, so they'll move the sticks. Herman Jones goes wide to the right. Second man through is Springs, and Springs goes down rather quickly. Tom Cousineau has a father who is very proud about his son playing football for Ohio State.
Our wife and I have been watching our son Tom play football since he was in the fourth grade. It was certainly a thrill for us when he decided to go to Ohio State, but this has to go down as one of our greatest thrills, coming down to Miami and watching him play in the Orange Bowl game.
Tom's father looks like he could play. Second down and 8. Ball at the 46-yard line. Gerald with a long count at that line of scrimmage this time. Handing the ball off to Springs, and Springs gets into Colorado territory at the 49-yard line. Lola Tye had to make the stop, number 52. Getting up in your picture. It'll be third down and 3 to go from the 49 of Colorado. 9:55 to go, third quarter. Ohio State, I am sure, has learned that, well, maybe I'm not so sure that Michigan lost this afternoon to USC. I don't know if Woody Hayes would let that information get in there. Let them go play their own game. Third down. Gerald coming out, trying to turn it up, now stepping back inside, and is going to get his first down at the 45-yard line. He is nifty, and he is quick.
Mark Haynes made an excellent play, forcing Gerald to do something swiftly with the ball. The only problem is when you force him to do something, he usually does it effectively. You can see he cut down the two blockers he had for interference. Now when he cuts back, he does pick up the first down, all on his own ability.
Goes to the ball nearly on the 45. Herman Jones goes wide to the right. Second man through is Springs. And the Buckeyes are beginning to eat up yardage, 4 and 5 yards of tries. Spivey makes the stop at the 41-yard line. It is second down and 6 to go from the 41. And now Paul Campbell comes into that backfield. And as he comes in, a tight end. Nope, it's Logan coming out. Harrell and Jones both go wide to the right. Logan is in the fullback spot. That's Springs, the second man, the tailback, another first down at the 35-yard line where Reuben Vaughn had to make the stop. Along with Hartling. Hartling playing for Lavelle Short, who went out with an injured ankle but did come back. The middle guard, Charlie Johnson, went out and will not come back. Both teams, offensively and defensively, shuttling a lot of players in and out. And Bill Mallory, is he nervous? You tell me.
He's got to find a way to stop them because 4 and 5 yards of crack is too many.
First man through, Logan. And he's got about 3. Down to the 32-yard line.
We've been talking about their offensive line. They're big men. They're real dudes. It's Chris Ward, number 79. We see him on Gary Hartling. That time it was a standoff.
Well, there is Charlie Johnson.
Don't think he's ready for any more tonight.
Mm. I think we told you x-rays taken right here at the Orange Bowl proved negative. He does not have a break in that foot or ankle, but he will not play again tonight. Well, it may have taken too much time. Let's just see what happens. Gerald Hand on hip, kept the football. Patrick having a few words.
Flag down on the play.
Logan has gained 61 yards and 9 carries. Gerald has carried the ball 9 times for 62 yards. That was to lay the game. And Springs has carried the ball 14 times for 68 yards. Now you want to talk about running balance. Logan 61, Gerald 62, Springs 68.
Pete Johnson's carried it for several on about 8 or 9 carries, so they've just divided it up.
17-10 Ohio State. And to the second down and 13 to go. The ball now back on the 37-yard line of Colorado. That's Logan, and now it's coming around this way with Matt Jackson, and Jackson doesn't get too much. He's a speedy freshman that they want to get the ball to, but Randy Westendorf, the end on that side, played it perfectly along with Mike Spivey.
They did play it well, and you put the burden on the ends and the defensive backs in a play like that. The linemen have to pursue with the flow of the play. This time they weren't taken out of position. It looked like it set up pretty well, but they did make a fine play.
Now here's a third and long situation for Ohio State. Third down, 11 to go from the 36. Let's see what Rod Gerald does. Going back to throw, getting the ball away over beyond Harrell, who had a step on the defensive man. But Gerald had to deliver that ball in a hurry.
Well, you're never going to see too many men in the back in the defensive secondary when you're playing against Ohio State because most passes are a bit of a surprise. That time he did have a situation where he had one-on-one. Still have to hit him.
Sladaney will try. Are you ready? A 53-yard field goal. Boy, has he got a foot, huh? It is off to the side. It was plenty long enough, but off to the near side. And Colorado this time has held and will take over at the 20-yard line. First down and 10. 6:26 to go. Sladaney had the good foot, but put the ball off to the left. Well, they've called time on the field. 6:26 here in the third quarter to go, and as it was at halftime, so it is still Ohio State 17, Colorado 10.
Here come the hot ones from Pontiac. Grand Prix, one of America's most copied cars.
Of course.
Trans Am, so unique it remains uncopied.
All right.
Sunbird, America's hot new sports coupe.
Looking good.
And now Bonneville, the right car at the right time. Nobody's got it like Pontiac's got it.
And they've got it.
When you're hot, you're hot.
Get a Delco Moro Powerful New Start.
We came to this hot, dry, barren place to sing the praises of the Delco Freedom Battery, the battery that never needs water because of Delco's lead calcium grid system that allows us to seal the top, eliminate filler caps, and free you from battery care. For plenty of cranking power to start your car wherever you live in all kinds of weather, sing the praises of the Delco Freedom Battery.
Get a Delco Moro Powerful New Start.
One of the most explosive dramas of our time. Arthur Hill stars in the true story of Judge Horton and the Scottsboro Boys, Monday at 9, 8 Central and Mountain Time on NBC.
Colorado has had two excellent opportunities here in the third quarter. Had a field goal be far short, and then after recovering a fumble, they're immediately intercepted by Tom Cousineau. Now they've got the ball for the third time.
And Jim, they haven't really sustained any prolonged drives, but they have had the ball in excellent field position, and they have created that with some big plays. They're going to have to get either another real big play pretty quick or get some sustained drive going.
This is Knappel carrying the football for a loss. Across the way, and guess who is there? Tom Cousineau.
Take a look. Now, this is an option play. He tries to hold a few of the defensive linemen with a fake to the offside. When he pulls, here's Bonamici right behind him. He knows he can't slow down or cut up. The whole team seems to catch up with him. It's just dragged out for a two-yard loss.
Well, Tony Reed came in here with that average of better than 4.5 yards per carry, but with the exception of one notable run toward the end of the first half, we've not seen really Tony Reed get an opportunity to do much of anything. Right ahead goes Mayberry. James is a sophomore, number 39, quicker, smaller than Jim Kelleher, who normally starts at fullback, and Aaron Brown made the stop. Maybe his number's 39, walking through the huddle there. And now suddenly it is third down and 11 to go. Colorado got the football, but in two downs have lost a yard. Jeff Knappel rolling this way, looking to throw this way, gets the ball away for Gaudy. He makes the catch and then drops the football. When he was hit, Gaudy dropped the football. Went high in the air to make an outstanding catch, and Ray Griffin lowered the boom, and the ball dropped loose.
Well, he'd have definitely held on to the ball had Ray Griffin not made the jarring tackle he made. He came all the way over from his free safety spot. You see Knappel throw the ball just as Gaudy gets by Mike Guess. However, as he's still up in the air, Ray Griffin's in a perfect position, lowers the boom on him. It's pretty hard to hang on to the ball under those conditions.
You should hear the Ohio State people talk about Ray Griffin is about to field that punt and get down the sideline. Ray Griffin knocked out of bounds inside the 5-yard line by Spivey. There's a flag down back upfield, and the Colorado team is back at midfield and said, hey, fellas, come on back this way.
It looked to me as if they thought he was going to run out of bounds. They've got him pinned pretty tightly to the sideline. Tries to make a hit out of bounds. He never does touch that stripe. However, it looked to me as if there might have been a clipping coming. There goes Ray. Looks like he's saying, hey, you better not hit me.
Ball is placed down at the 48-yard line. Robert Carpenter, our official, and I never did see the signal. They simply placed the ball down. Perhaps he stepped out of bounds over there at the 48-yard line. I guess that's what did happen because there was no signal at all as to a penalty and no yardage stepped off. Jeff Logan, a couple of tough yards, maybe a yard. Luxlow made the stop. And it's second down and nearly 10 to go. 4:38 left in the third quarter. 17 to 10 Ohio State. Herman Jones wide to the left. Darrell play action trying to get it to Harold. He does. Dragged down inside the five. Play action by Rod Gerald, freezing everybody, and Harold burst through.
And they fooled him, there's no doubt about it. Gerald pulled it at just the proper time. Mark Haynes has been in their backfield several times tonight. He's the man that they ran right by as Harold went free as a bird, came back. You're going to do some work in the opposing team's offensive backfield. You're going to have a little trouble covering the deep one.
4 minutes left to go, and that big powerhouse backfield comes in, which includes Pete Johnson. They love to give it to him in a situation like this. And they give it to him in a situation like this, and he gets down to about the two. Westendorf and Lolotai combining for the tackle. And it's second down and goal to go. Well, Griffin's punt return was called back, and immediately they come right back with a play-action pass to Jim Harrell, taking the ball inside the five. Ohio State looking to go up by 14. They're up by 7 right now. Give it to the big fella again. Oh, he is stacked up. Stacked up hard. The excited man was Frank Patrick. So excited, I thought he had a fumble recovery. He didn't. He simply stacked him up.
They stood him up right at the offensive line. Lolotai gets in, makes Johnson come to the outside, and Frank Patrick made an excellent tackle.
Storr comes in as a tight end. Ferguson comes out for Ohio State. Third down. Here's the big play. Gerald rolling, looking for Harrell, and throws. Incomplete.
Jim, from our angle, it looked like Harrell was wide open. However, those defensive ends and the big tackle got up there, put their hands up, and you almost can't see your receiver when they're that close to you, and you have to put the ball over their head.
That is Tom Skladanian for a field goal try of much closer. This will be a 20-yard attempt to get Ohio State up by 10. Ladani's kick is good. 20-yard field goal by Skladani. 2:30 to go. Third quarter. Ohio State at one time down 10 to nothing. Now leads by 10, 20 to 10.
There's a challenge in the sunrise. He can hear the highway call. City roads and top roads, he can take them all.
The Goodyear American Eagle. A strong, smooth-riding radial with Flex-10 cord belts instead of steel. Flex-10 is made from a flexible man-made aramid fiber that's pound for pound stronger than steel.
A tire for America. The American Eagle.
Very nice work, Brother Dominic.
Thank you.
Very nice. Now, I would like 500 more sets.
You do a big job for me.
The Xerox 9200 duplicating system can automatically reduce, duplicate, and assemble countless sets at an incredible 2 pages per second.
It's a miracle.
Jim sets with John Brody, and that is Charlie Johnson. Middle guard, out for the evening. Got that injured right ankle, popped up along the bench.
And you know he's sick, because he knows just exactly how much he's needed.
264 pounds. Good, quick middle guard out of there. Ladani kicks this almost out of the end zone. That is what Woody Hayes and Ohio State called the beer can kick. Non-returnable. The folks in Atlantic City are so sure legal gambling will save their town, they're already practicing their roulette and blackjack, and right now you know what they're using? Play money. In about a year, they will use real money and perhaps have real trouble. A special report later tonight on Weekend, the NBC News program, which isn't like any other NBC News programs or anybody else's. 2:30 to go. Colorado's Golden Buffs looking to get something going before this ball game slips away and into the night. It's 20 to 10 Ohio State. And Knapple throwing on first down, gets the ball away, and it is almost caught across the way by Tony Reed. That play worked once before.
That's right, but on that occasion, Ed Thompson was coming after the quarterback,
This time he took a perfect angle to upset the play, and Knappel threw the ball pretty well. It just wasn't open.
Last time it linebacker blitzing, this time it a safety blitzing, and each time Knappel picked it up, this time the execution wasn't there. Second down 10 from the 20. Dawney's had a couple of almosts in the last 5 or 10 minutes. One that was out of bounds, another that he had before Griffin popped him one. Wide to the right. Knappel having to throw nearly every down now. Has some time, puts it up deep. Down the sidelines and out of bounds. His intended receiver, and that is Billy Waddy.
He really never did have a chance to complete the pass because Ray Griffin played the play perfectly. He's the free safety. He goes back. He's responsible for the deep half of that side of the field. He's got it all the way. You can see the two of them running right out of bounds. He picks up the ball. He's aware that they're playing on the outside the boundary line.
All right, the Golden Buffs. Third down and 10, or they'll have to surrender the ball back to the Ohio State Buckeyes, who've been just running it wild. Knappel on the fake, gives the ball off to Reed, and he barely gets back to the line of scrimmage. Allegro is there, and Brzezinski is there, and Colorado's kicker is there. Valesky has to come back in and kick it away again.
They're just not giving him any opportunity to break loose.
Allegro and Ray Griffin go deep. Last time Griffin had the long punt return, remember? But they said he stepped out of bounds. Koleski takes an extra step and then kicks the ball away. Might have mishandled the ball, and it goes down to the 45-yard line of Ohio State. Well, the Buckeyes will get it, first down and 10.
Almost kicked his fullback in the rump.
A 35-yard kick, taking the ball to the 45-yard line, and time is out on the field with 1:42 to go here in the third quarter in balmy Miami. Ohio State 20, Colorado 10.
I used to be hung up on labels. My clothes had to be made in Europe, and so did my car. Then one day I drove a new Pontiac Sunbird. The style, the comfort, the power and handling. It was a revelation. So I bought a new Sunbird. You know what? I'm hung up on labels all over again.
Pontiac, the mark of great cars.
Roses are red, violets are blue. Light beer from Miller, I love you. You got a third less calories than the regular beer, and really are less filling, which is something to cheer. But what I like above all the rest is the way you taste, you are the best. Yes, blue is the violet, and red is the rose, and if you don't believe me, I'm gonna break your nose.
Light beer from Miller. Everything you always wanted in a beer, and less.
First down 10 from the 45-yard line. Harold has caught a couple of important passes tonight. The wing back is wide to the left. First man through, Jeff Logan, only gets maybe a yard. Remember, tomorrow we begin our second year of regular season college basketball. Grandstand will be on the air at 1 o'clock, and then we've got a couple of, well, real good ball games. Michigan and South Carolina in one game, and after that, UCLA and Houston. They're four big names in basketball. And, of course, we go right on through to the NCAA Finals. Second down 10 from the 45. Gerald pitching out. This is Springs, who Steve, what extra effort for Ron Springs. Gets across the 50 to the 49-yard line. It'll be third down and nearly five to go. Hartling made the stop along with Roth, number 55. We are late in the third quarter, Miami, with 49 seconds and counting to go. Since Colorado led 10-0, Ohio State has put 20 points on the board. Harold this time wide to the right. Colorado looking to hold to get the ball back. That is Springs, and they're going to contain him. It'll be fourth down. What a tackle by Mark Haynes, the fine freshman. Number 18. Fourth down. Ladany comes in to do the kicking again.
Loss of the yard.
Bobby Morris goes deep. Along with Billy Waddy. Morris is number 3. Waddy is number 38. And Bob Hyatt comes into the Ohio State backfield. This is the first punt. And that is the end of the third quarter. They've gone through three quarters of play in this 43rd annual Orange Bowl Classic. Ohio State, representing the Big Ten, leads Colorado, representing the Big Eight. At the end of three quarters, 20-10.
That's me, Wally Funk, air safety investigator and spare time pilot. Sure, I take risks for fun, but when it comes to my money, I'm really careful.
So Merrill Lynch showed me ways to be on the safe side and still get a good return. One was high-grade municipal bonds, 6% tax-free. I like that.
At Merrill Lynch, you don't have to take big risks to share in America's growth.
You know, you don't have to be a star to have your car treated like one. Texaco thinks every car should be treated like a star with good maintenance and our good gasoline. That's one reason Texaco is America's largest selling gasoline, with our Sky Chief, Fire Chief, or lead-free Texaco, all with protective and detergent additives. So if you must drive, see your independent Texaco retailer for our good gasoline. At Texaco, we're working to keep your trust.
The season premiere of college basketball features Michigan against South Carolina and Houston against UCLA tomorrow, beginning at 1:30 Eastern Time on NBC.
Look at all the communication majors, Jimmy.
Think
they like that too?
They may not be communication majors, but they know what communications are all about. Kladanian to kick the ball away as we begin the fourth quarter. Angling toward the sidelines. And it is going to bound out on the four-yard line. Colorado, which needs some points on the board, at 96 yards to go. Well, a week from tomorrow. I hope you'll be around. There's going to be a basketball game, Maryland and North Carolina State on NBC. And once that is over, a switch to Pasadena, where today USC beat Michigan in the Rose Bowl 14-6, and where next week, Oakland representing the American Football Conference, Minnesota representing the National Football Conference. They call it Super Bowl 11, and NBC has it.
Right here, Jim, they would love to have the opportunity to hold on and move it out of there, but it's... Yeah, I tell you, it's come down to the time where they have to move it out of there any way they can. They can't afford to sit there and keep turning the ball over. They're going to have to fire it, even though it's not the optimum situation to be doing it.
Kelleher carried the ball. Brown and Bonamici made the stop. It'll be second down and 9 from the 5-yard line. Colorado has a history of outscoring their opponents in the fourth period. They have to pull a little wizardry here because Ohio State's playing excellent defense. Colorado's been playing good defense lately, but it may be a little bit too late. Knappel in the end zone, gets the ball away, and Allegro tries for the interception across the way. Ball was intended for Hasselbeck, the big, tall tight end, 6'7". Allegro, who's 5'11", jumped up and nearly made the interception.
Well, Joe had to play the whole way. Now, Hasselbeck is real big, and he had to find a way to get in front of him because a guy like Hasselbeck can sit and move his body to where nobody can get in front of him unless you get the jump on him, and that's exactly what Allegro did.
Third down and 10, and a play coming in from the bench. Knappel waits hands on hip to see what it is. That's the clue now. If Bill Mallory's got a play, here's where he needs one. Doesn't need a few. Knappel hands off. Cody Reed does not get the first down out near the 10-yard line, and Colorado's going to have to give up the football again. Brown and Cousineau made the stop. Dan Kolesky comes in to kick the ball away. The Golden Buffs, you just get the feeling, are hanging on and hanging on. They only allowed 3 points in the third quarter, but for nearly all Ohio State, Kolesky gets away a good kick. Might be returnable. Logan at the 45-yard line. Going to go the other way. That's the wrong way, Jeff. Back to the 47 goes Logan. As excellent coverage led by Reuben Vaughn puts him down. Carter was also there. 35-yard kick, the 2-yard return. But Ohio State's got the football again and again in Colorado territory.
2-yard loss on the return by
Rod Gerald comes back in to call a play, sending Harrell out wide to the left and Herman Jones to the right. Logan and Springs the setbacks. Gerald throwing on first down. Flag is down, intended for Jones, and it is no good with Spivey back
But there's a flag back at the 49-yard line. Legal procedure or motion, charged. Question is, do they want the 5 yards or do they want the down?
Talking about what Colorado's defense wants, they have been to the task the last two times Ohio State's had the ball. It may have had some inducement to encourage Rod Gerald to throw the ball on that occasion, but they really need a big defensive spurt here, because if Ohio State's able to control the ball, get down to get some more points, it's going to be long sailing.
Bob Hyatt now comes wide to the right. Gerald fakes, quarterback draw, and it does no good. Other than gaining him perhaps a yard, Roth makes the stop. Next Saturday, we've got a doubleheader here on NBC. The Senior Bowl, everybody will be down in Mobile, Alabama, and all of the top college seniors from the North and the South begin at 1 o'clock. The Southern team is to be coached by Don Shula of the Dolphins. The Northern by Forrest Gregg of Cleveland. What a job he did this year. And then after that, regional basketball action getting underway at 4 o'clock. So that's quite a Saturday, and followed by a Sunday basketball Super Bowl doubleheader. Third down and long again, or else Ohio State will have to give up the ball again. Gerald is going to run with the ball, and not for much, and it's going to be fourth down. Stuart Walker made the stop, along with Buck Slow. Well, Colorado's had its hands on the football, but has not been able to move the football in this second half.
Sclodini's had him down there around their goal line. It's a pretty tough place to operate against a defense like Ohio State's.
Well, I was more remembering more specifically the twice they had it within the 30 early in the third quarter and could not move the football. Ray Griffin comes in, added to the kicking team, and Tom Sclodini is the kicking team. Last time he angled it out on the 4-yard line, remember? Looks like he's trying to go this way again, too. This one is going to be caught right at the 11-yard line by Bobby Morris. It'll be first down and 10. Colorado still does not have much working room here at the 11-yard line. There's a flag back upfield, and everybody's walking back upfield, and Colorado wants it back upfield, so apparently it's against Ohio State. I would imagine they'd want anything over rather than have the ball at the 11-yard line again.
I don't think the 11's the optimum spot.
Bill Mallory, an intense young coach at Colorado. He's been there as head coach for 3 years. At the Orange Bowl luncheon the other day, he was intently outlining his team, whereas Woody Hayes, the man who's been around for 31 years as a head coach, 26 at Ohio State, was Mr. Calm, Mr. Smooth.
Hey, Bill Mallory has, I think, as much respect as I've ever seen a coach have from his players and his staff both. And I've never been with a man that's easier to work with.
He's all of that. 12 minutes exactly to go. Legal procedure, they will kick the ball again. Colorado looking for some kind of return. Fair catch called, and they actually picked up a couple of yards this time as the ball is on the 9-yard line. Fair catch called by Bobby Morris. 11:52 to go in the ball game after the 40-yard punt, and the score remains the same, 20-10 Ohio State.
If you're looking for luxury in a full-size car this year, first look at the luxury available in Pontiac's new Bonneville. Feel the luxury in Bonneville's exciting new size. Then test drive it and experience Bonneville's new hush of luxury. For this year,
isn't it beautiful?
Luxury comes first at Pontiac.
Pontiac, the mark of great cars.
I mean, it was really a good movie.
It was good,
yeah.
Wasn't it?
Oh, honey, look, some poor guy left his lights on.
Larry.
Is he going to be in trouble?
Larry.
Boy, am I glad it isn't me.
Larry, It is you.
It is me. Oh.
The Diehard has extra power to start your car when most batteries won't. Starting soon in your neighborhood. Sold only at Sears.
first time on TV, a major motion picture tells the real story of the most daring rescue of our time. Raid on Entebbe. Super Bowl Sunday at 8, 7 Central Time on NBC.
Well, it's a long way to go, 91 yards, but the Golden Buffs of Colorado will try once again. First down at their own 9. Knappel with the football, pitches it out, Tony Reed, and Reed gets back to the line of scrimmage, and that's about all. There's Brzezinski on top of him, along with Mike Guess. Second down and 10.
I think the one thing, you know, people discuss establishing the run, Jim. I think they've established that it's going to be pretty difficult to run for the rest of the evening, and they're going to have to find some way to throw that thing up top, because the defense of Ohio State has just been a little bit too strong up front.
Donnie comes wide to the left. Fullback gets the football, Kelleher. And he gets up to about the 12-yard line. Cousineau and Bonamici make the tackle. Ohio State has done an outstanding job tonight of containing Tony Reed, who came in here with over 1,200 yards during the regular season, the leading pass catcher. And Colorado folks consider him an outstanding pro prospect. That he may be, but tonight he's having his troubles. Big plays for the catch of the pass coming out of the backfield. Knappel goes up top, and nobody's there. There's a flag down back at the 12-yard line. Jennifer Hasselbeck. And Ray Griffin now limps off the field as though he might have pulled a muscle or turned an ankle.
He sure hurt.
Procedure called against Colorado, and they're going to take the incomplete pass, Ohio State is, and kick the ball away. Ray Griffin's a junior. He has another year. An outstanding offensive player, fought it over his mind for a long while and finally decided, I'm going to play defense. And he was also bowing to the needs of Ohio State. They needed a defensive back. All right, Don, going to be behind a submariner looking at the legs of center. As Koleski, who is in the submarine, gets away a very poor kick. Very poor kick.
I think as much as anything, Jim, the kicking game has dictated the outcome and the flow of this whole game. Skladany's had an outstanding night, and Colorado's kickers really haven't had that good a night.
Koleski gets off a punt of 17 yards and gives Ohio State perhaps a field position it needs to put this game away. 20 to 10, Ohio State leading Colorado. We've got 10:26 to go. And now time is out on the field, and both teams walk back to their huts.
The American Eagle, Goodyear's symbol for its all-American kind of radial tire. Goodyear is committed to product innovation. We introduced rayon cord in tires. We created the polyglass tire and the polysteel radial. And now the American Eagle, with belts of Flex-10 cord instead of steel. Flex-10 is made from a flexible man-made aramid fiber that's pound for pound stronger than steel.
The tire for America, the American Eagle, the tire. Coke is like, it's got a taste and a feeling you like. Coca-Cola, Coca-Cola. Come on, girl, gotta share a Coke with you. Coca-Cola. Let the feeling show through. You wanna live a little bit more. That's what the taste of Coke is for. Coke is like, everybody wants a little life. Coca-Cola, Coke is like.
First and 10, Ohio State. Ray Griffin along the sidelines. Apparently a cramp. We're guessing, but that's the way it looks. Here's Gerald carrying the football, being strung out, pitching the ball out to Springs, and he's run out of bounds after picking up a couple of yards. Colorado has done a fine job on the running of Ohio State here in the second half. But Ohio State has done an outstanding job against Colorado, allowing them just 23 yards rushing in the second half. Second down and 7 to go. Colorado needs the football, needs field position, and needs to go up top and get some points. Right now, they need to stop Ohio State. Herman Jones wide to the left. Gerald keeps the football. It's knocked forward down to about the 20-yard line. It'll be third down and short yardage. Vaughn is the man who made the tackle, number 75. And right there with him was Stuart Walker.
Take a look at Randy Westendorf. He's not a very big defensive end. He's about 192 pounds, but he's an active one, and he's been in the act all night long. Now, they've been trying to run at him, and in the last three series haven't had much, really had much success.
Third down and two. Pete Johnson is in there. Is that what they're going to do again? That's what they normally do. That's what they do again, and Johnson is knocked back, and he may not have gotten that first down. Frank Patrick, number 64, gave him a big hit. Everybody knows that Johnson is normally the man to get the ball in that situation.
Here you go. Let's take a look at the defense. They get good defensive penetration. Lolotai makes a real fine play, getting underneath the whole pack, stacking up everything, and the rest of the defenders coming to clean it up. Now it's fourth and a foot.
Fourth and a foot, and you would expect Johnson again, but Logan is there, and Harold is there, and Gerald can carry the football. Oh, Johnson's got it, and plenty more. Down to the 15-yard line. Moved it out with Cabral making the tackle, along with Haynes.
Whereas they were effective at stopping at the play before, let's take a look at Bill Lukens, Lou Petrini, the whole right side of the offensive line. They get their job done this time, stand the people up, and give Pete Johnson a chance to do his work on the other side of the line.
First down at the 16-yard line. Second man is Springs, and he has tackled a fine tackle. And that is Patrick, who's a very enthusiastic interior lineman, number 64. Every time he makes a stop, he puts his hands up like it's a touchdown or recovered fumble.
He's made some pretty key ones tonight.
He sure has. Remember, if you did join us late, Colorado led 10 to nothing. It is now 20 to 10, Ohio State with 8:20 to go. And again, in the Sugar Bowl today, Pittsburgh 27, Georgia 3, in the Cotton, Houston 30, Maryland 21, in the Rose, USC 14, Michigan 6. Gerald, and this is Springs, trying to get outside, and he's going to get outside for a yard or two. To about the 9, where Cabral and Haynes knock him out of bounds.
Jim, you know those plays look like they're going for a yard or 2 yards, but that play, for instance, was a 4.5-yard gain. Now, they're moving them out offensively in the line. I guess I better quit repeating that, but that's really the success factor for Ohio State.
Ron Springs comes out, and Big Pete Johnson comes in. Tonight, he scored his 58th touchdown of his Ohio State career. Third down and 4. Gerald carries the football inside the 5-yard line. Tom Perry, number 33, ran him out of bounds, along with Mike Davis. But that's going to be a first down Ohio State at the 3.
Let's take a look at the whole, you know, when you watch a quarterback that can run the ball pretty well, he's got to be able to fake it pretty well. This time, I believe we fooled the old camera. When you can do that, Rod, you can certainly fool the defense.
There's that big backfield again. And there's that Pete Johnson again, battling down near the goal line. Ron Springs tonight has carried for 81 yards, Gerald for 77, and Logan for 64. Logan was a big man in the first quarter with a 36-yard run and has hardly been called on a run with the ball since. 7.5 minutes left. Second down and, oh, about a foot to go. We'll take a look as they come to the line of scrimmage. It's nearly a yard. And Colorado wants another timeout to get itself set up, to get itself, if it can, all together defensively. Timeout, Colorado. 7.5 minutes to go. Pete Johnson talking to the trainer there. And it's 20 to 10 Ohio State, and the Buckeyes are near another.
This is the beginning of a new four-cylinder engine from Pontiac. Cast iron tough, but smooth, with 2.5 liters of Pontiac power. This is the Iron Duke, and only Pontiac's got it. In the sassy new Astra, the classy new Sunbird, or the great new Ventura, a tough, smooth, powerful four. Made by Pontiac, the Iron Duke was born to rule.
How about a little beer talk? You see a lot of people drinking beer right out of the bottle or can, and well, that's okay. But when it's convenient, why not pour your next beer into a sparkling, clean glass? Looks better, doesn't it? Tastes better, too, especially if it's Budweiser, because Bud is brewed in beechwood aged to kick up a big, creamy head of foam that you just have to see to appreciate. And a taste? A taste that says it all.
In the Orange Bowl, Jim Simpson with John Brody, and the Buckeyes from Ohio State trying to put a little insurance on the board here with 7.5 minutes to go. A touchdown. If you're up by 16, the extra point 17. With only 7.5 to go, Johnson tries to fight his way in and does not get it. And it is third down, and that is Lolotai, number 52, getting up. And down at the bottom of the stack is McKinney. Otis McKinney. Let's pause briefly for station identification. This is the NBC television network. Third down on the yard. And there's that man again, and he lost the football. And it's dove on by, well, that's grammar for you. You get the idea. Colorado got the football.
Boy, their defense has been tough up front. I'll tell you, this second half, they've been put against it four times, and they've done their job, each and every one of them. When you only have a foot to go against a group that outweighs you a bit, you've got to cut out for it. They've met Pete Johnson three times in a row down there.
That's the fourth fumble tonight for Ohio State, and they have lost them all. And Colorado gets the football back. But again, they give it back 97 yards away. Five, he recovered. Next month and a half, NBC Sports lineup will include some golf. John and I are going to be out for the Joe Garagiola Tucson Open on the 15th and 16th at the Bob Hope Desert Classic. And Bob even has a special coming up on NBC on January 21st. Lots yet to happen. Kelleher fights his way out. When Ohio State has had Colorado down inside the 10, despite the fact that time has been oozing away, Napoli has played it safe most of the time, generally going to his fullback. On one occasion, he was chasing into the end zone and did throw.
I'm sure he'll throw now. He knows if they're going to win the game, they're not playing to look good. They're trying to win. He's got to score twice within 6.5 minutes, and he's got to put it upstairs.
Pitch out, and getting some running room is Tony Reed. Across the 10-yard line. And it'll be third down and a couple to go. Allegro ran him out of bounds. 6 minutes left, 20-10, Ohio State. There have been several big stories in this game. Number one, the outstanding defense of Ohio State. Number two, their ability to run inside on Colorado, especially so after Charlie Johnson was injured. And that, I think, is about the football game summed up. Apple hands, and straight ahead goes Kelleher, trying to get that first down out near the 15-yard line. And I believe he's got it. They do. They're moving the sticks.
Let's just take a look right here. You can see you get the ball to the big fullback when you have a foot to go. If there's no room underneath, you go up over above. Kelleher picks it up.
Gaudy comes wide to the left. Waddy is to the right. Colorado's looking for some points. Getting the ball out to Reed, and Reed is knocked down. Perhaps a loss on the play. Tony Reed, as we've said before, has been bottled up. Aaron Brown made the tackle along with Eddie Beeman. And it is second down and 11. And we'll check some statistics on Tony Reed, just how well he has done tonight. Because he is the man who carries the ball most for the most yardage and catches the ball most for the most yards. He's carried the ball 20 times for 55 yards. About 2.5 yards per carry. Napo gets it away for Gaudy, and there might be a flag thrown, and there is. First down out across the 35.
And that's exactly what he has to do. Obviously, it's nice when you can run past, get into a situation where you can do either. He's not in that situation. He has to throw it, and he has to throw it down the field quite a ways. This is the kind of break he needs. It's going, he's going for the ball. You can see Allegro come in trying to make a play and got tangled up with him. That gives him a big break, the first good field position they've had in about 12 minutes.
20-10 Ohio State, 4:58 to go. The ball now at the 35-yard line of Colorado. And more importantly, a little room for Jeff Knappel to throw. He is not backed up. They carry the ball, put it back to Gaudy, who's going to throw, getting it up for Moorhead, who is there, but the ball is overthrown by about 5 to 7 yards.
Roche made an excellent play. Now, he's the man that has to come around on that reverse. When they made it effectively work early in the ball game, it opened up pretty well. However, he didn't sucker in. He saw Moorhead down there trying to delay him and then go. He stayed right with him and beat the play.
Second down and 10. Colorado looking for a quick score if it can get one to draw close. And then who knows, anything can happen. And should they score, what a turnaround that fourth fumble of the ball game would have been. Knappel, diving catch across the way, attempt at least by Gaudy, it is incomplete. So Gaudy has figured in the last three plays. He interfered with, threw a pass, and this pass was underthrown. He could not make the diving catch.
That's right. It's the kind of play that it's a timing play. It's very tough to execute, especially with a rollout quarterback. He rolled out about 4 or 5 steps, and you really don't have your balance under control the same way you do if you're dropping back. And when he threw it to the sideline, he just threw it a little bit quick. Gaudy came out of his break and couldn't get to the ball.
Byron Cato, number 71, has come in. Over the defensive line, he is a good defensive lineman. And pass rusher, and he's on him right now, and the ball is thrown into a crowd attempting to read incomplete. But that was Cato that was fighting his way at number 71 and made Knappel throw the ball away in a hurry, and it's fourth down, and Colorado's going to have to give the football up again. And again, the Ohio State defense does an outstanding job, and Ray Griffin, with that leg cramp or whatever it was, he is back in the ball game, and quickly they pull him out. He ran out on the field, and they said, you come back. Gillespie, who did not get a good kick away before, kicks this one well to Jeff Logan at the 20-yard line. Ohio State, a ball control team, will try to control the ball now with 4:35 left in the game. They'd like to win this 43rd Orange Bowl Classic, and they lead by 10.
You'll never regret the purchase of a good stock.
You don't say.
Yeah, my broker says it's a real good buy. What does your broker say?
Well, my broker's E.F. Hutton. And Hutton says...
When E.F. Hutton talks, people listen.
Hey, this is the Texaco uniform you know best, your independent retailer. But there are 75,000 people behind him, like the Texaco drilling teams, and the people who move the oil to the refineries, and the Texaco engineers who refine the crude oil. It's a big job, and Texaco does it all. That's why Texaco is a big company, big enough to do the whole job. We're working to keep your trust.
Catch all the action as the Minnesota Vikings take on the Oakland Raiders in Super Bowl XI next Sunday, beginning at 3:30 Eastern Time on NBC.
Here's an Ohio State team that managed but 9 points in its last two games of the regular season, with 20 points in this ball game, and having the football leading by 10 at their own 20-yard line with 4:35 left. Keep that on the ground. Ron Springs has had a good day today and picks up a couple of yards here. Roth is on top of him. Westendorf is there. And Lolatai is also there. Second down. And about 8 to go. Colorado has had the football, but has not been able to move the football. Their biggest play here in the second half has been the interference call.
Early, you know, the first possession, they moved it pretty well, Jim, on some big plays. Since then, they really haven't been able to do anything.
Gerald hands off, first man through. He's quick. Jeff Logan. It'll be third down and 3 to go from the 28-and-a-half-yard line.
You can see his reaction. When he gets through the end of that secondary, that's when he really excels. And that time he got there, his lineman got him there, and he slipped trying to make a turn.
Frank Patrick comes in. He's made a couple of those big tackles lately. Reuben Vaughn goes out. On the short yardage situations, Patrick, who's a big man, 242, comes in. Of course, the man who replaces Wade is nearly 250. Down they go, and look who's up top. Patrick. And that means it's going to be fourth down. They'll have to kick it away again, and with 3:15 to go, Colorado calls time. They want the football, and they want something to happen once they get the football. Well, again, about our college basketball, our Super Bowl, our Senior Bowl, remember we're going to have golf, the Tucson Open, January 15th and 16th. We also have the INA U.S. Pro Tennis Championships. That'll be in Philadelphia on January the 30th. Then that Bob Hope Desert Classic, staring you right in the face there, on February 12th and 13th. And I think I told you before that on January 21st, from 8:30 to 10 o'clock, NBC is going to have another Bob Hope special. The taping of this week out in Lake Tahoe, Bob is going for names like Mac Davis, Olivia Newton-John, Sammy Davis Jr., and Margaret.
Pretty good lineup.
Not bad. Here's a pretty good kicker, Tom Skladany. He has been outstanding tonight. Here's a senior. This is what he's been averaging tonight.
It's an excellent average, but where he's put the ball is even more.
Billy Waddy, you saw him, 38, and Bobby Morris, 3, are the two deep men, hoping that they can make something happen. High pass from center, but lots of time, and another boomer. Bobby Morris, no fair catch, 31-yard line. Down he goes at the 35-yard line. A 40-yard kick and a 5-yard return. Colorado's got the football again with 3:08 to go. Down by 10 points.
Bobby Morris took the kick.
And Jeff Knappel, the sophomore from Boulder, trying to make something happen here.
I think he's done about as good a job as you can expect him to do under the conditions. When you're not moving him out of there up front, it's pretty tough to operate either way.
Apple dropping back, has some time, off the hands, intercepted by Thompson. Thompson across the 35, across the 30, ridden down. And that might dispel Finney to any hopes of the Golden Buffs of Colorado. Thompson returned one interception for a touchdown this year, but this is just as big to him here in the arsenal.
As you see, Knappel's going back. He's throwing back. Little rollout to the left, throws back, has his man, Hasselbeck. However, the ball hits him in the hands, bounces off his helmet. Thompson comes up with a little bit of a fumble play. He was in a good position. He's made a lot of good plays all year long.
The ball is at the 28-yard line. Harrell comes wide to the right. Ohio State can nearly run it out right here. Second man through. Springs gets inside the 20-yard line, and Springs is getting near the 100-yard mark. He's had an outstanding. When they moved Jeff Logan from tailback to fullback when Pete Johnson went out, Springs came in as a tailback. And thus far has gained 94 yards tonight. Second down and 2 to go with the ball at the 19-yard line. And Bill Mallory, he and his staff, John Porter said at the outset that for the Big 18, for Colorado, this is a big game. For Bill Mallory, a very big game. He thinks he's got his program going, and he really wanted to win one. He said he'd walk back to Colorado if he won the championship. Carrying the trophy, Jeff Logan's got the first down and more inside the 15-yard line. There is Jeff Knappel. Remember, grandstand tomorrow preceding college basketball. Lee Leonard, Bryant Gumbel will be there starting at 1 o'clock Eastern Time. Fran Tarkenton has a special report on the Super Bowl. He's going to play in it. Barbara Hunter interviews Ken Stabler. He's going to play in it. And also Willie Brown in Oakland's Jack London Square. An up-to-date look at your college basketball scene. And to do that, an interview with former UCLA head coach John Wooden. That sounds good tomorrow starting at 1 o'clock on grandstand. First down. First down, Gerald hands to Springs. He would like to get near the 100-yard mark, and he's getting closer and closer. Down to the 8. Roth made the stop. He has 98 yards now. And Ohio State has its first trip ever to the Orange Bowl about wrapped up. The first Orange Bowl I did, John, was 15 years ago today. It was in the afternoon. Colorado was here, and LSU beat them. I guess they don't want to see me come back.
I think you're going to see Colorado back.
Good ball club. They'd like to play it at full strength. And Charlie Johnson got hurt. Had they had a chance, that won some of it. Jeff Logan gets inside the 5-yard line. Here another first down. Clock running with 1:12, 1:13 to go. Logan has had a good night. And again, to repeat for you, because this game is winding down, in case you have just come in and did not have a day full of watching television football, Pittsburgh, number one in the nation, nearly shut out Georgia, 27-3 in the Sugar Bowl to New Orleans. Houston got a big start on Maryland, beat them 30-21 in the Cotton Bowl. At UCL, USC down 6-0 to Michigan, came back to beat them 14-6 in the Rose Bowl. Full house backfield. That is the fake to Logan. Gerald carries the football for the score.
He got him spread out again, Jim. Every time he gets him spread out, something good happens for Ohio State. I think we've mentioned many turning points in the ball game, but I think Rod Gerald's play is the most contributing factor to Ohio State's score. Here we go again. Makes a quick fake to Jeff Logan. He's got the trail back, Harrell. He's coming out. Now, who do you watch? Once he gets you spread out, you're in trouble, folks, and he runs it right in the end zone.
Well, they said he's quick, and he is indeed that. Missed much of the season. Did not play in the last two games, which they lost, but he's playing here tonight. He's got a couple more seasons ahead of us with 80. Adds yet another extra point, and with 45 seconds to go, it is 27-10. Ohio State was down 10-0 when Pacetta, the starting quarterback, fumbled. It was picked up, and a 26-yard field goal was kicked by Zetterberg. And later, there was a 10-yard touchdown pass to Moorhead from Apple, and it was 10-0. And then Ohio State came back. Gerald came on. Logan in the fullback spot ran 36 yards for a score. Ladany in the second quarter early on kicked a 28-yard field goal to make it 10-10. And since then, it has been all Ohio State, highlighted by their 99-yard-plus drive with a score tied at 10-10 for the go-ahead touchdown. There's Gerald. Spadani will kick it off. The ball game is out of hand now.
I don't think we're going to see any more of Lou Petrini or Bill Lukens, Mark Lang, the whole offensive line, Jim Savoca and Chris Ward, but they did it. They did it. They did it.
He's going to try to bring it out. This is an offensive play. He might as well try to go all the way if he can. He is still on his feet and gets out across the 35-yard line. 37 seconds to go. Our thanks to Gene Autry, president of the Orange Bowl Committee, Dan McNamara, the executive director, Hal Fleming, the production manager, publicity director, Gil Sloan. A special thanks to the 133 members of the Orange Bowl Committee. They've given unselfishly their time all year long to make the spectacular events of the Orange Bowl Festival possible. And from Colorado, Eddie Crowder, the wonderful athletic director, Bill Mallory, what a fine man he is, his staff, Mike Moran, the sports information director, also a spotter tonight. And from happy Columbus, Ohio State, Ed Weaver, the athletic director, Woody Hayes, the head coach and his staff, Marv Holman, the sports information director, his assistant, Steve Snapp. Gentlemen, we thank you all as the pass is incomplete. It's headed downfield or Hasselbeck, and beyond him was Gaunty. 32 seconds to go, second down and 10. The co-champion of the Big Ten is about to beat the co-champion of the Big Eight, Ohio State, to beat Colorado. Other Big Eight teams have done very well in postseason play, while the other Big Ten team, Michigan, stubbed its toe this afternoon. So both conferences have a right to be happy in some cases, upset in others.
What's that old saying, on any given day?
I never said it. Second down 10. Colorado just trying to get something going. Napo will be throwing again if he can. Flings it out there for Tony Reed, and Reed tries to put the move on, and there are only about seven Ohio State men around him as he gets to the 40.
That must be the way he must feel like they're 70, because that's the way it's looked all day long for him.
Colorado's going to take one more timeout with 20 seconds to go. The big play that Colorado tried to pull when they got an interference penalty out near the 40-yard line, and the score still 20-10, was to have their wide receiver Gaunty throw the ball. He had a man in the clear, but overthrew him by 7 to 10 yards.
He launched it, but he had to let Moorhead get down the field a little farther.
And that was about the last gasp for Colorado. Third down. and six to go. The Buckeyes in their first ever Rose Bowl, or I should say Orange Bowl appearance. I said that. Woody Hayes said, "Thank you, Mr. President of the Rose Bowl," the other day at the Orange Bowl luncheon, but he did it deliberately and then turned around and smiled and said, "Orange Bowl." That was a good game this afternoon in the Rose Bowl, speaking of the Rose Bowl. Close all the way until late in the fourth quarter when USC put another score on the board to make it 14-6. Yes, there is a moon over Miami, and for the most part, it's shining on those from Columbus, Ohio, the Buckeyes. Apple play action pass, gets it down for Moorhead, who's been an outstanding receiver tonight when they've got the ball near him, and he's down to the 30-yard line with 12 seconds to go. That's the first down, and we'll stop that clock right with 12 seconds to go. They'll want it as soon as they're ready. There's a flag thrown way over here near the Ohio State bench.
It's because they have a man that went off the wrong side of the field, I believe.
That's Waddy. He was on the Ohio State bench, and so now he's going back to the other side. Legal procedure.
Maybe he likes the way Ohio State's playing better than that.
First down and 15. They have just about played out the string here in the 43rd Orange Bowl. Apple and company ought to do something here. Moorhead is the man in motion. Gets the ball across, and that is Tony Reed inside the 30-yard line. Reed trying to get away a nifty run for once tonight, and there he goes down as time goes out. And Ohio State has defeated Colorado 27-10 after trailing 10-0. And Ohio State's defense looked excellent, and their offense was more than sufficient to put points on the board. Colorado will be looking for no excuses, but they have a slight excuse in that their middle guard, Charlie Johnson, 264 pounds, did not anchor the middle of the line. And yet, without him in the second half, Colorado did an effective job.
I really think, Jim, that Bill Mallory's had a great year. As we mentioned early in the year, early in the broadcast, he was expected to come in sixth. Now, I think an indication of that is that all his offensive line are sophomores and juniors. They're going to be tough to contain in the years to come, the next two particularly. And I think Bill Mallory's put together a great program. I think the guy's going to have a lot of success in the future. I like the way he plays football. I think he puts a lot of wrinkles into his offense. And I like the fact that he didn't kind of give up and say, okay, we lost the ball game when it's 27-10. He's still scrapping it out, trying to get anything he can.
And back in Columbus, Ohio, where, of course, they have 80,000 or more people every Saturday afternoon to watch a football game, and it was very disappointing for them when they had to struggle to beat Minnesota. And then in their showdown with Michigan, they were shut out 22-0. And Ohio State did not go to the Rose Bowl. Instead, they were invited to the Orange Bowl, where they made an excellent representation for the Big Ten. And after being down by the score of 10-0, came back to win it by the score of 27-10. So the Buckeyes are happy, and the Colorado folks, if they're not happy, have reason to be proud. Because this Orange Bowl game tonight, at the end of the half, was 17-10, wound up 27-10. Our congratulations to Ohio State. This is Jim Simpson with John Brody from the Orange Bowl. And once again to you, Happy New Year. To you, from John and myself, and from NBC Sports.
NBC reports 3.5 startling hours, violence in America, Wednesday at 8, 7 Central and Mountain.